Okay. So homogenization is a concept which is useful in solving a lot of locus questions. Okay. Now, what is this concept? It says that if there is a second degree equation, if there is a second degree equation, which actually can represent either a conic or a pair of straight lines. Okay. So let's say there is a conic. I'm just drawing a rough structure of it. And there is a straight line Lx plus My plus N equal to zero. Okay. So this is a conic or a pair of straight lines. So this may be a conic or it could be a pair of straight lines. And we have Lx plus My plus N equal to zero as another straight line. Okay. And let's say these two intersect. Okay. Something like this. So this yellow line is your Lx plus My plus N equal to zero. Okay. So let's say this point of intersection is P and this point of intersection is Q. Okay. And let's say there is origin over here, 0, 0. And from this origin, I draw a pair of straight lines connecting origin to P and origin to Q. Okay, so let me explain the event once again for the people who joined in late. So now I'm dealing with the concept of homogenization. Okay, I'll tell you why we call it as homogenization. In this concept, we are dealing with a second degree equation, which may represent a pair of straight lines or it may represent a conic. Okay. And there's another line, Lx plus My plus N equal to zero. So what is this line doing? This line is cutting this conic, okay? And is cutting it at P and Q. Is that fine? Now there's an origin over here. From this origin, I'm drawing two lines. Let me name it L1 and L2. Connecting origin to P and Q, P and Q being the points of intersection of the line Lx plus My plus N equal to zero and this conic. Okay. Now this L1 and L2 combined equation is obtained by homogenizing the equation of this conic with the help of this line. Let me repeat what I said. The combined equation, let me write it also, the combined equation of L1 and L2 is obtained by homogenizing the equation of the conic with the help of this line. And how is that done? All of you, please pay attention to that. Okay. So those who have joined in, please settle down. Okay. So now I'm discussing how to find out the equation of a scenario where there is a conic cut by a line and from the origin you are joining the points of intersection. So I'm trying to find out the combined equation of L1 and L2. Okay. Good afternoon to everyone who has joined in. There's still more to join in. I don't know why they are delaying it. You should never miss the initial part of the class. Okay. Now the combined equation is obtained by homogenizing. Now why do I need to homogenize first of all? Now go back to your understanding of the previous class. A pair of straight lines which is passing through the origin is a homogeneous second degree equation, isn't it? Yeah. Do you recall that? A pair of straight lines passing through the origin has to be a homogeneous second degree equation. Correct? That's why I have to homogenize this conic with the help of this line. How do we do that? For that, step number one. So these are the steps that we follow. Step number one, we first write down this line equation like this. Okay. Then we divide it by minus n throughout and we obtain this expression equal to 1. Okay. Step number two. In step number two, we write down the conic equation. Okay. In this manner, that is the second degree with terms, we do not do anything with it. While the first degree terms, let's say 2gx is a first degree term. So we'll put 2gx into 1. Again, 2fy is also a first degree term. So I'll put 2fy into 1. And c is a 0 degree term. So I'll put into 1 square. Now you soon realize, what will I do with these ones which I am writing? What I'll do next is, I will use this information, let's say I call this one, in the second equation. Okay, so I will use one in two. Okay, so the second degree terms, they will be unaffected because in the process of homogenization, I'm converting everything to a second degree term. So this linear term 2gx into 1, 1 will be written as lx plus my by minus n. Get this clear, guys? This one has to be replaced with this expression lx plus my by minus n. Okay? Similarly, this one also will be replaced with lx plus my by minus n. Okay? And C into 1 square. 1 square will be basically the square of this expression. So lx plus my by minus n the whole square and equal to 0 will remain equal to 0. Okay. Now you can see here that I have converted this to a homogeneous second degree equation. And this would be actually be representing our pair of straight lines L1 and L2 equation. Is that fine? Now, people who joined in late, first of all, good afternoon. Are you, say something here. At least write something. Okay. So how is the time going on in your house? I mean, are you studying hard or just sleeping off? Nafil is attending classes. Okay. What about RNR? Something is going on. I think Dhyan told me that computer classes are starting. Okay. Thanks to the NPS administration that they are doing so much for you guys. Okay. Chalo, we'll discuss this concept once again for the people who joined in late. First of all, you should not join in late. It's very important. You can leave early. That's fine. Don't join in late. Okay. The concept here is the concept of homogenization, where we are going to learn how to find out the equation of the pair of straight lines connecting origin to the intersection of a conic and a line. So basically you can see this is a conic. Let me write it here, conic. And this is a straight line. Lx plus my plus n equal to 0. So conic equation is given here, straight line equation is given here. Okay. We are looking for the combined equation of the pair of straight lines L1 and L2. For that, what process we do? We do the process of homogenization. In homogenization, the first step is we write the equation of a line in this way. Okay, divide by minus 1, we get this expression. Then what do? We take the equation of the conic and whatever are the second degree terms, we don't disturb them. So this remains as it is, this remains as it is, this remains as it is. And in 2gx term, we put an extra 1 over here. Okay, similarly in 2fy term, we put an extra 1 over here. And in the constant term, we put c into 1 square. Okay, now what we do? We replace these ones with this expression lx plus my by minus n. So wherever I have written 1, I'm going to replace it with lx plus my by minus n. And now I claim that this newly formed equation that you have here is the equation of L1 and L2 combined. Now how do we justify this? Why is this working? First of all, if it is a homogeneous, it must pass through origin, correct? So it is taking care of the fact that whatever equation I have is passing through origin. Okay, that is number one. That's a necessary thing that we had to satisfy. Number two is, if you see P point is a point, let's say I call this P point as alpha beta point. This P point simultaneously satisfies this line equation as well as this conic equation, isn't it? Yes or no? So you see that this P point is going to be satisfied even by this particular equation. Okay, so even this equation, which I'm showing with a double tick mark, that will be satisfied by alpha beta. How? Let's check. So this will become A alpha square. This will become 2H alpha beta. This will become B beta square. This will become 2G alpha. And this, let me tell you, since alpha beta also lies on the line, this will still remain a 1 for us. Okay. And Again, 2f beta. This will again be a 1 for us. And this will be c into 1 square. Now, please note alpha beta will also satisfy conic. And what you have is the conic equation, which will actually become 0. Same will be true even for the point Q. So what I have done, with one arrow, I have shot two birds. Okay. In Hindi, we say it, ek teer se do shikar. Correct. So I have not only converted it to a homogeneous equation, I have also made it satisfy the line as well as the conic. And it is also passing through origin. That means it can only represent a pair of straight lines, which is basically connecting O to P and O to Q. Is that fine? Any question regarding this, please let me know. This is a very useful concept for solving locus questions. So I'll write it down over here. Useful for locus,
Locus
questions. Yes, sir.
So, but we don't know A, H and B, right? Like A, H, B and all. We don't know those.
Sir, it will be given. Yeah. These two will be given to you. Don't worry. This will be given. This will be given. Okay. Fine. And then you will be given, ask the condition. Is that fine? Any question here, anybody? Yeah, sure, Aditya. Don't waste time copying it. The notes will be shared with you. Don't worry.
How is the RHS 1 in the step 1?
Sorry?
How is the RHS 1 in step 1?
How is the RHS 1 here?
Yeah. No, Lx plus My by minus n is equal to 1.
So one thing you tell me, if you divide both sides by minus n, what would you get on the right hand side?
Oh, yeah. Yes.
Okay. All right. Yes. So let's have a question to understand this in a better way.
Sir.
Yes, sir. Tell me.
Sir, can the conic equation also be a pair of straight lines?
Yes, like, it can be. It can be.
Can be, sir.
It can be. Just a second. Pair of straight lines. We are here. Okay. Yeah. Okay. So let's have a very, very simple question over here. Okay. I hope you can read this question. The question says, find the condition that the pair of straight lines joining origin to the intersection of this line and this circle may be at right angles. Okay. So the situation goes like this. I'm just drawing it roughly for people to follow. So this is a circle. Okay. Having a center at origin. Okay. And there is a line y equal to mx plus c. So let me show that with a blue line over here. Okay. So this line is y is equal to mx plus c. And this is your circle, which is actually a conic. Now, the condition they're asking is, what is the condition that a pair of straight lines joining origin, this is your origin, with these two points. Okay, so let me just draw them. What is the condition that this becomes a right angle over here?
When's the diameter?
I'm sorry?
No, sir.
Try this out. Try to see how you can fit in the homogenization concept. Very easy. Let's have 2 minutes for this, guys. Not more than that. Let me know when you're ready with the condition. M is equal to plus minus 1. Okay. So any line with a slope of either 1 or plus 1 will make a 90 degree at the center. Are you sure, Shamik? any line I make that will separate the 90 degree. There can be infinitely many lines with slope of plus minus 1. Yeah, that seems to be correct, Shishti. Okay, let's see what others have to say. That seems to be correct. I'm not commenting whether it's actually correct or not. Y is equal to plus minus 1. Why would a condition involved? Okay, Aniruddha is also saying M is equal to plus minus 1. Okay. Again, the same mistake which I think Shaumik is also making. Okay, can we discuss this quickly? Anybody else who wants to respond? Tripan, Ajay, Ananya, Anjali, Ariman, anybody want some time? Okay, I'll give you 1 more minute. Okay, so Tripan also is ready with the condition. Okay, Tripan. Okay, chalo, time to discuss. Fine, and let's all of you please pay attention. Okay, now those of you who said M is equal to plus minus 1, can you unmute yourself and tell me how did you get that condition?
Sir, I made a mistake, sir.
Yeah, same, sir. I forgot.
Okay, so people who have said M equal to plus minus 1, okay, they take back their answers. Okay, fine. Now, coming to the answer of Shishti and Tripan. Okay, good. Let me discuss it. One of you is correct, by the way. So now, what is happening here is it is the concept of homogenization, isn't it? So first of all, if I say, get me the pair of straight lines L1, L2 equation. So what I'm going to do is, the second degree terms, I'm not going to disturb. Okay. Whereas this a square, I will write it as a square 1 square. Remember, a square is a constant. It is like your C of that, you know, general second degree equation of a conic. What is M over here? All of you see here. M will be obtained by doing this step. Okay, first you take the mx on this side and then divide by a C. So this is your 1. Okay, this 1 you have to replace over here, my dear. Getting my point? So this 1, y minus mx by c, you have to replace over here. And when you do that, let's see what comes out from this exercise. So it gives you y minus mx by c the whole square. Getting my point? Right? Let's try to simplify this even further and express it as a homogeneous second degree equation. So please allow me to take the c square on the other side. Okay, something like this. Right now, let me bring x square to one side. If I bring x square to one side, I get a c square from here, and I would get a minus a square m square from here. Okay, now let me take y square on the other side, and there's already a c square, and from here I would get a minus a square. Okay, now there would be an xy term also, okay, with some coefficient, but I don't care about it. Can somebody tell me why? Suddenly, I am saying I don't care about this. I don't care about this. Why? Can you tell me why?
Sir, because for the perpendicular condition, only a plus b should be equal to
zero. Absolutely. Very, very good. See, for the perpendicular, now what I am claiming here is that these two pair of straight lines represents perpendicular lines. And when can that happen? When can a pair of equation, let me write it like this. When can a pair of equation, ax square, ax square plus by square plus 2hxy equal to 0 represent a pair of straight lines when a plus b is 0. Remember this. This is the condition for perpendicularity of the two component lines. So what I'm going to do here, I just need to do this and I'm done. This should be 0. That is the coefficient of x square, coefficient of y square will add up to give me 0. So that will give me 2c square is equal to a square 1 plus m square. And this is the condition that I desire. So this is going to be my answer. Any question, boys and girls? Please stop me and ask. So I think some silly mistake had happened. Shishti? Yes. Yeah. She has corrected me. Ashish, now it is clear where you went wrong. Shankin? Shankin, I understand your question. See, my aim is to make a second degree term everywhere. Now, there are so many ways you can write one. I understand it. But does this expression of yours help me to make a second degree term? Tell me.
No, sir.
No. That is why this expression of one is desired. This expression of one is desired.
Okay, sir.
Getting a one. Okay. Let's have one more question. Let's be confident about it because we are going to use this concept. I think in one of the doubts, Shaumik asked about homogenization. Okay, so you'll get the answers over here, Shaumik. Don't worry. So let's have another question. Let's take this one. Now, try to solve this by homogenization. Okay, there may be other ways also to solve it. But see whether you can apply homogenization to solve it. Read the question. Prove that the pair of lines joining origin to the intersection of the curve, this curve is an ellipse curve, we all know that, and this line are coincident. Okay. So the pair of lines are coincident. If this condition is met, if this condition is met, now, if you read this question, it is actually like saying that this line is a tangent to this ellipse, isn't it? So you can solve it by condition of tangency also. I don't deny it. But let's use our homogenization, which we have learned just now. Let's have 2 minutes for this. I'm sure you can do it in 2 minutes. Just type done once you're done. Okay, so let me also pitch in. I can see some people writing done. Okay, Shristi is done. Very good. So see, what is happening is that there is an ellipse, okay, and there is a straight line. Okay, of course, this is an ellipse whose center is at origin. Correct. Now, what is the question saying? The question is saying that if you connect this point over here, okay, this angle over here should become zero because they are coincident, isn't it? Okay. Now, we all know that when will this happen? When this will become a tangent at this point. Okay. So, you could solve this question very easily by using the condition of tangency. Okay. So, approach one. So, I'll write it down. Method number one. Those who were with us last year would know what is the condition of y equal to mx. I'll write it down. COT. Condition of tangency for the line y equal to mx plus c to be tangent to an ellipse. What is this condition? Can anybody unmute and tell me what is the condition? C square is equal to a square m
square
plus b square. Very good. This is the condition of tangency. If you use this, you can solve this question in one shot. Okay. So c here, what will be the c here? C will be minus n by m. Am I right? Yes or no? Okay. So c square is equal to a square, m will remain minus l by m. Okay, so the m of this line. So basically, you have to convert this to y is equal to mx plus c form. So it will look like this: y is equal to minus lx by m minus n by m. Okay, so this is playing the role of my m. This is playing the role of my c. Right? So I need this m and this c, right? Okay. Plus b square. Now multiply throughout with m square and your answer is ready. But this is not how I wanted to solve this question. I will use another method, that is method number two, which is the concept of homogenization. Meanwhile, any question with respect to how I solve this by using condition of tangency? No, right? So those who have not done this chapter, you need to look into my videos on Centum channel. There are almost 42 lectures on conics. So please have a look at them. Okay. We'll be also doing some concepts after our theory of equations and limits chapter. Okay. Now, method number two, how do we solve this with homogenization? Now, in this equation, will I disturb this term? No. Will I disturb this term? No. It's already second degree. Will I disturb 1? Yes. I'll write 1 as 1 into 1 square. Correct? And what is this 1 going to be? This 1 is going to be your lx plus my by minus n. Okay? So this 1 here, I would replace it with this. Okay? So I am homogenizing it. Okay? Very good, Siddharth. So now if I do that, see what happens. It becomes x square by a square. Y square by b square is equal to lx plus my by minus n the whole square. So let me write it like this. This by n square, I'll take it to the other side. Okay, first let me write n square here. Okay, let's take the n square on the other side. So you have something like this. Sorry. Okay, and on this side you have l square x square m square y square. And you'll have plus 2LMXY. Is that fine? Now let me convert it to a proper homogeneous form that we have known it like before. So this minus L square. Okay. And here Y square N by B square minus M square. And minus 2LMXY. Minus 2LMXY. Okay, everybody is fine till this step. Now, this is your A, this is your B, and this term that is 2LM is basically acting as your 2H term. Okay, now, what is the condition that the angle between the lines here is zero?
H square minus AB is equal to zero.
Correct. So that means H square should be equal to AB. Correct. So H square will be what? h square will be l square m square, correct? AB will be the product of this and this, correct? No, let me open the brackets. Let me open the brackets. I get l square m square. Here I'll get n4 a square b square. I'll also get minus l m square n square by a square minus l square n square by b square plus l square m square. Okay, so I'm just opening the brackets on the right hand side. So this term and this term will get cancelled. Zero will be left off over here. Now what I'll do, I'll also drop off n square. So drop n square. If you drop n square, you'll end up getting 1, sorry, 0 is equal to n square by a square b square minus m square by a square minus l square by b square. Okay. Now let me simplify this further. Let me just take it to one side and multiply with a square b square. So l square b square plus m square b a square multiplied with a square b square will be your n square. So that gives you a square l square and m square b square, or you can say b square m square equal to n square. Is this the condition we desired? Yes, this is the condition we desired. I understand this is a long route to do it, but I just wanted you to apply the homogenization concept. Okay, so multiple way of looking at the same thing. Are you confident, guys? Type confident on your chat box if you're confident. Okay. Now there are certain cases where it doesn't need a line and a second degree curve to homogenize it. Okay. Homogenization can occur between two second degree terms also. Okay. How it happens, let me show you in a different type of a question. So let me just pick up a different question altogether. Right. Let's have this question. Everybody read this question carefully. Show that the straight lines joining origin to the point of intersection of these two curves are at right angles if this condition is met. Now see here, for a change, both are second degree equations, isn't it? Okay. How will you solve this kind of a question? Let us try to solve this. First of all, I would give you around 1 minute to try. Let's see if anybody is able to get this and write done once you're done. Only two people were confident. Okay, never mind. It'll take me a few more questions. Just give it a try. I'm not expecting you to solve this question, guys. Just give it a try. If you have to solve this question anyhow, whether homogenization or any other process, how will you solve this question? Okay. Anybody, any success? Okay. Now see here. Ultimately, I have to get the equation of the lines joining the intersection of these two curves with the origin. Okay, Aditya. For Aditya, I'm going to give 1 minute. Okay, Aditya. Oh, Anjali also wants 1 minute. Fine. I'll wait for 1 minute. Yeah, are we good to go, guys? Anjali, Aditya? Okay, thank you, dear. So let's see. See, what is my aim? My aim, again, I'm reiterating, I need a homogeneous second degree equation, boss. That's it. This is my requirement. Now, by hook or by crook, whatever, I want that equation to come from these two equations. Okay. Now, what I'll do is, they're already of second degree. So what I'll do, I'll linearly connect them. Okay. So I'll, just like you form a family of curves, right? I'll connect them as 1 plus lambda times the other. Okay. All of you, please see. What is lambda? I will tell you what is lambda in a while. Don't worry. Okay. Now, I'm claiming that the second degree term that I would get would be a family member of these two second degree curves. Now, what lambda I need? I need such a lambda. I require such a lambda that makes the first degree terms vanish. Remember, this should be a homogeneous second degree equation. That means there should be no term containing x. There should be no term containing x. That is my aim. Very good, Ayush. Okay. Excellent. So now what I'll do is, the second degree terms, you can just collect it like this, a lambda a dash x square. Okay. A lambda a dash x square. You'll have xy, in fact, 2xy h plus lambda h dash. And you will have b plus lambda b dash y square. Okay. And apart from that, you'll have 2xg minus lambda, sorry, plus lambda g dash. Correct. So if you want to see a homogeneous second degree term, tell me, boys and girls, should this term be present? Should this term be present? No, right? This term should not have been present. Right? Only these three should have been present. So if you don't want these to be present, and it can only happen in the way where you have this term is zero. So your lambda should be actually such a value which will make this as zero, which indirectly gives you lambda value as minus g by g dash. Are you getting my point? If you choose your lambda like this, you'll end up getting a homogeneous equation, which will be a pair of straight lines passing through the origin, which will be a homogeneous second degree equation. Are you getting my point? This is a very, very crucial step. Feel free to stop me if you have not understood why did I do this. Okay. All right. So let's complete the question. So now if you complete the question, you have already eliminated the last term. So you can put back your value of lambda. So A, and lambda is minus G by G dash A dash X square. And two, okay, by the way, I don't care about this term. Why don't I care about this term once again? I need the condition for them to be at right angles. So whatever is this XY term, okay, I don't care. Okay, don't waste time doing unnecessary things in competitive exams. You don't have that, you know, leeway of time to spend. Now, y square will be b minus g g dash into b dash into y square equal to zero. Is that fine? So the condition of tangency, sir, can we equate both the initial equations? If you equate both the initial equations, you'll end up getting the two points where they intersect. But however, we needed the equation of the pair of straight lines connecting those two points with the origin. Okay. Right. Now, all of you, we have reached the final step. If this has to represent perpendicular lines, what can I comment about this plus this? Zero. Yes or no? So A minus G by G dash A dash plus B minus G by G dash B dash should be equal to zero. Should be equal to zero, correct? Which clearly gives me the final blow to this problem. A plus B is equal to E dash A dash plus B dash, which is nothing but G dash A plus B is G times A dash B dash. Done. Proved. This is what we wanted. Any question, boys and girls? Okay, I can see a few questions. Correct, Shashank. A plus B should be zero. Okay. Okay, before we close this topic, I want you to be still more confident. And one more question I'll give you before I end this. And then start with the new chapter, Theory of Equations. Let me go down. Okay. So this is the question for you all. Prove that, I could have given this as an objective question also, but let it be. Prove that the angle between the lines joining the origin to the intersection of this straight line with this curve is this. This type of question is very common in CET. Okay, Aditya has a question. Can we divide the two equations? Well, yeah, well done. See, okay, so just give me a second. Just give me a second. There is some question coming from Aditya. Guys, you could have also done the same problem. Let's say if you don't want to get into this lambda business, you could do one more thing. You could multiply, all of you please see here on the top, multiply this with a G dash, multiply this with a G and subtract it. You would automatically get rid of the first term, first degree term. Getting the point? So this is also another way to do it. Actually, you're doing the same thing indirectly. Okay, so if you want your this term to go off, these terms to go off, another route would have been multiply the first entire equation with G dash, multiply the second equation with a G, subtract it off. So these two terms will get cancelled and you'll be left with a pure second degree homogeneous equation. Okay, Aditya, does it solve your purpose? Let's do this. Can we have 3 minutes to do this? Oh, it was there in the homework question. Okay. Just type done once you're done. Yes, 3 minutes is over. Anybody with any success? So the process is well defined, you guys. You just have to follow it and avoid any silly mistakes. Okay, let me do it along with you. Okay, done in the homework. A little more time, okay? Let's have one more minute. Aditya is done. Very good, Aditya. Okay, very good. Many of you have done. Let's discuss this quickly without much waste, and then we can start a new chapter, theory of equations. Okay, so all of you please pay attention. What is the agenda over here? The agenda is, there was a curve, okay, and there is a line. I need to find out the angle between these two lines which you are making from the origin to P and Q. So obviously homogenization will help you out. Okay, so first of all, what I'll do, I'll write y is equal to 3x plus 2 as y minus 3x by 2 equal to 1. Okay, and then the second degree term, I'm going to write it like this. Okay, instead of 4x, I'll write 4x into 1, and 1 will be replaced by y minus 3x by 2. Okay, similarly, 8y into y minus 3x by 2. Minus 11 into y minus 3x by 2 the whole square. Okay, let's do a simplification of this. So I end up getting x square 2xy 3y square. Okay, I'll end up getting from here 2xy minus 6x square. From here I'll end up getting 4y square minus 12xy. From here, I'll end up getting minus 11 by 4 y minus 3x the whole square equal to 0. Okay. Let's do one thing. Let's multiply throughout with a 4 and then I'll open this bracket. So let me make those changes directly. 4x square, 8xy. Okay. Let me group up terms first. Before doing that, let me group up whatever terms we have outside. So x square will be obtained from this guy and this guy, which is minus 5x square. Okay, so I'm taking care of these two. Don't think that I'm canceling out. I'm just grouping up terms. So 2xy, 2xy into 12xy will be like minus 8xy. I'm taking care of these. Okay, and I'll have a 7y square. Minus 11 by 4 by minus 3x the whole square. Okay. Now let me multiply with the 4 first. So minus 20x square minus 32xy plus 28y square minus 11. And let me open the bracket. Y square minus 6xy plus 9x square equal to 0. Again, opening the bracket will give me minus 20x square minus 30. Now here 66 was there. And minus 32 is here. So I'll end up getting how much? Plus 34xy. Okay. And 28 was there. And this will give me 17y square. Correct? Is there anything which I missed out? Anybody please point out if I missed out on anything?
So even the x squared.
There was an x squared term. I forgot that. Sorry. So this will change. This will become minus 190. Sorry, plus 190. Minus 190. Yeah. Oh, this gives very ugly figure. Okay. Okay. Now let me divide throughout with minus 17. That will give you 7x squared minus 2xy minus y squared. So I divided by let me write it down. I divided throughout with minus of 70. Okay. Now, what is the angle between the two lines which comprises that pair of straight lines? 2 under root of h square minus ab by modulus of a plus b. So that is 2 under root of h square. H here is 1. H square is 1. Minus ab is going to be plus 7 by mod of a plus b. A plus b is 7 minus 1. Okay. So 2 root 8 by 6. That's nothing but 4 root 2 by 6. That's nothing but 2 root 2 by 3. So theta is going to be tan inverse of 2 root 2 by 3. Okay. Slightly calculation intensive, but the approach was pretty much the same. Correct, Aniruddha. Correct. Okay. So I'm sure after this, you are very, very confident about how to use homogenization. So thank you very much to this chapter. And now I'm going to begin with a new one. Okay. And the chapter is theory. Let me show you my artistic skills. Theory of equations. Okay. And let me put some decoration also. Okay. Yeah, it's a completely new chapter. So welcome to the new chapter now. The chapter's name is Theory of Equations. Now, actually, this chapter is not a chapter at all. It is actually an ingredient. It's actually a tool which everybody must know, because in maths, you are solving problems everywhere, correct? In fact, in real life also, you are solving problems, right? Corona right now is a problem, right? And getting the vaccination is like getting the root, right? Or getting the solution of that equation, isn't it? So in maths, you'll come across different types of equations. It may be trigonometric equation. It may be algebraic equation or polynomial equation. It may be equations involving modulus functions. It may be equations involving GIF function, fractional part function. It may be differential equations, right? So many equations are there in maths. So we need to learn how to solve at least the basic ones. Trigonometry you have already done, guys, correct? In the trigonometry chapter. So in this chapter, I'll give you an overview what we are going to learn in this theory of equations chapter. This chapter actually is not only about equations. It's actually about solving. Oh, sorry. Let me change the pen color. It's about solving equations and inequations. So not only we'll be learning how to solve equations, we'll be also learning how to solve inequations. Inequation means inequality involving the variable. Okay. So the structure of this particular chapter is we are going to cover up how to solve, first of all, a polynomial equation. How to solve a polynomial equation as well as an equation. Okay. Under that, a lot of emphasis will be given to quadratic. Okay. Because we never did quadratic officially in class 11th. So now the time has come that we take a deep plunge into this topic, quadratic equation. And also we'll see some glimpses of how to solve higher degree polynomial equations. Okay. How to solve higher degree polynomial equations. Okay. Second thing that we're going to talk about, how to solve equations which involve special functions. Equations which involve special functions. What are these special functions? Special functions are like your modulus function. Okay. They're like your greatest integer function, least integer function. Yes, we are going to introduce something called least integer function also. The fractional part function. The fractional part function. Okay. So equations which involve them, we are going to talk about those equations as well as inequations. Okay. And finally, we are going to spend some time solving exponential and logarithmic equations and inequations. Okay. Now it seems as if there are only three topics to be dealt with, But let me tell you, this will minimum take two and a half class for us. So here 1 hour is already gone. So don't consider this class to be complete. So probably this class, next class, and next to next class will also be required. Okay. It's a huge topic. Well, let's not waste time and move forward. The first thing that I would like you all to answer is, what is the difference between, what is the difference between a equation and an identity? I know this is a very silly question to ask, but let me tell you, people do make mistakes when questions related to them are asked in the competitive exams. Equation has a solution. That means identity doesn't have a solution. Okay, Shashank is saying identity is true for any case. Okay. Okay, in general. Equation is fixed value. Okay, any other opinion? Identity is variable. Okay. Any other response? Identity has condition. Okay. Oh my God. Okay. Okay. Thank you guys for your response. Okay. Some of you are absolutely correct. So let me clear up this misunderstanding. Identity is something. It's a kind of something equated to something which is actually true for all values of the variable. For all values of the variable. Okay. That means any value, provided the functions involved in that identity are defined for those values, will satisfy an identity. A simple example of it is your Pythagorean identity, cos square x plus sin square x. Okay. Now, any value of x for which cos x and sin x is defined, we know it's defined everywhere, will actually satisfy this equation. So this will be satisfied for all values of x. This will be true for all real numbers. Okay. So when I say sec square x is 1 plus tan square x. Okay. This is going to be true for all values of x, provided it doesn't make your tan x and sec x become undefined. So basically you say excluding odd multiples of pi by 2. Okay. And being some integer. Okay. So this is also an identity, which is defined, which is true for all values of x, provided they are defined. Okay. Whereas a equation is true only for certain values of x. Is true for certain values of x. Certain values of the variable. That is the x over here. Okay. And these values basically are called the roots of that equation. Okay. Since I mentioned a trigonometric example over here, I will continue with the same. Let's say cos x is equal to half. Okay. Is this equation, is this an identity? No. Because it may not work for all angles. Zero will not work. Okay. 30 degree will not work. Okay. It is only satisfied for values like pi by 3. 2 pi minus pi by 3, 2 pi plus pi by 3. So in general, what do we write for this? 2n pi plus minus pi by 3. Okay. So only these values of x will satisfy it. Okay. So these are called the roots of this equation. So they will be called as the roots of this equation. Okay. Now you must be wondering, why is sir speaking about such a simple concept? We all know this. If you know this, then I have a question directly for you. And let me tell you, many people have not solved this question, which I'm going to give you next correctly. Oh, sorry. Where is that? Theory of equations. Okay. So let's have this question. Okay. Now what I'll do is, I'll give you options. Okay. Option A. So the parameter can be, so lambda can be option A, minus 2, option B, 2, option C, 3, option D, all the above. Okay. Read this question carefully. I'm running a poll for this. Once you're done, I want you people to respond by pressing a poll button. Let's have 2 minutes. Time starts now. If this equation is satisfied by more than two values of x, find the parameter lambda, and these are the options: -2, 2, 3, all the above. Okay, Pratham. Okay, Arpita. Very good. Guys, last 10 seconds to vote. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, go. Okay. I'll stop the poll now. Look at the results. 36% janta says D. Okay, then 32% janta says B. Okay, so janta is going with option D. Okay, let's check it out. Now, if you look at this equation very carefully, it actually is a quadratic, right? Nobody can deny that it actually is a quadratic expression, isn't it? This expression is a quadratic polynomial. Okay, and we all know something called fundamental theorem of algebra. Okay, what does it state? It states that any degree n polynomial equation can have or has exactly n roots. Okay, so if it is a polynomial equation, then it will have exactly n roots. Okay, now these roots may be real, these roots may be non-real, but all together, if you add the roots, there will always be as many number of roots as the degree of that polynomial equation. This is something which we call as the fundamental theorem of algebra. It's a very, very basic theorem which you cannot violate. Okay, now this is a quadratic equation, and under no means I will have more than two roots for this. In fact, I should have exactly two roots, not less, not more. But the question gives us a surprise that it has more than two values of x satisfying it, which clearly indicates that this is actually not an equation, it is actually an identity. This is something which you need to understand and appreciate. It is not an equation, because had it been an equation, it cannot violate the fundamental theorem of algebra, and it will not have more or lesser number of roots than two. Okay. Now, here comes the approach. If it is an identity, then it is not only true for more than two values, but it is true for any value of x. Okay. So if you want this to be true for any value of x, it can only happen when these coefficients that you see, okay, I'm underlining these coefficients with black, oh, sorry, with pink, okay. These coefficients that you see, they should all be individually be zero each, because then only your outcome will become independent of x. That means left hand side and right hand side both will be zero every time. So you need to see for what value of lambda will these three equations simultaneously be satisfied. So you have to see they are simultaneously satisfied. Simultaneously satisfied. Okay. Now these are very easy to solve because they are factorizable. Thanks that they are factorizable. So the first one is factorizable as lambda minus 2, lambda minus 3. That gives you lambda value as 2 or 3. The second one gets factorized as lambda minus 2, lambda minus 1. So that gives you lambda value as 2 and 1. The third value again, the third equation, that is lambda minus 4, again gets factorized like this. So lambda is 2 or lambda is minus 2. Now which value is simultaneously satisfying all of them? 2. So your answer is lambda is 2. This is your answer. So Janta, didn't I tell you many people would make mistake? Janta was wrong. Option B is correct. So those 32% people who replied B, they were correct. Guys, you understood your mistake? Okay. Is that fine? Because 1, 3, etc. will make few of them zero, not all of them zero. Is that fine? Any questions? Okay.
Sir, in the fundamental theory of algebra, you said that nth degree polynomial can have only n rows. Sir, but in complex equations, when we solve equations, then they had sometimes had infinite.
No, if you take complex number equations, they also have the same number of.
Sir, but sometimes then the it was satisfied for. If like supposing some 2-degree equation is satisfied for one and two values.
See, it may have repeated roots. It doesn't mean that it has lesser roots. It may have repeated roots. For example, if I say square minus 2x plus 1 equal to 0, it has two roots, 1 and 1. But the condition will still be satisfied.
Yes, sir, not less. It had more than two roots.
Like, can
you I can't remember an exact. I don't know. I'll have to check. I don't know. But I remember there were some.
No, were they polynomial equations or were they special functions equations?
So, maybe they had modulus.
They must have special functions there. They are not polynomial equations. Fundamental theorem of algebra works for polynomial equations, which that's why I categorically wrote there. If there is a degree n polynomial, so any polynomial you make out of complex numbers or whatever, see, complex numbers are just names, they're just variables. It will not have, it will have exactly the same number of roots as a degree. But if let's say special functions are involved, let's say you're taking modulus or you are, you know, taking mod or argument, then probably the degree number of equations will become more or less.
Okay.
I understand your concern, Tripan. You are coming from one of the questions that we had solved in the class, right? I am coming from where? So they were not polynomial equations, my dear. Okay?
Okay. So, thank you.
Now, this is something which I actually ask every year. I mean, just to surprise people. There is a quadratic actually that I have. I know some of you would already be knowing this. Okay, this is a quadratic. Okay. All of you, please look at the expressions carefully, which I am writing. So this is a quadratic equation that I'm actually writing. Okay, this equal to 1, right? So basically, prima facie, it's a quadratic equation kind of a thing. Why I'm saying prima facie? Because it appears it's a quadratic equation. Okay. And of course, A and B and C are not equal to each other, because if they are, the denominator will become zero and the expression will be undefined. Okay. Now there's something very surprising about this equation. If you put x equal to A everywhere, you would realize that this equation is satisfied by this. Check it out. If you put x as a, this will become 0, this will become 0, and this will become a 1. So 1 is equal to 1, so a is satisfying. So a is a root of this equation, correct? Correct? Anybody trying to contest that? No? Okay. In the same way, even b will satisfy it. Check it out. Even b will satisfy this. So b will make this as 0, this as 0, and this will become 1. So 1 is equal to 1. Okay, so that is getting satisfied. So b is also a root of this equation. Correct? Even c, you will see that it is going to satisfy it. Check it out. So c will make this as 0, this as 0, while this will become a 1. Correct? So 1 is equal to 1. Now, isn't this surprising that this equation is having more than two roots? Right? It is violating the fundamental theorem of algebra. So actually speaking, this is not a quadratic equation. What is it?
Identity.
Identity, right? It's an identity, right? I would request all of you to actually check this out at home. If you expand this, you'd realize I've written something like 0x square plus 0x plus 1 equal to 1. That's actually always true. Okay? So don't be, you know, fooled up by such kind of expressions which are claiming to be a quadratic but having more than two roots. If it is there, straight away you have to declare it is an identity. Not only three, it will have more than three. It will have any value of x satisfying it. Is that fine? Okay. So as we discussed in our overview of this chapter, we are first going to talk about quadratic equations. So this is a giant chapter, actually. It looks like a simple x chapter, which you have already done in class 10th to a certain extent. But this chapter is huge. Okay. So what is a quadratic equation? So any equation of this nature, ax square plus bx plus c, okay, where your a, b, c belongs to complex numbers, okay, it can be complex also, but remember a should not be zero. It actually is a quadratic equation, okay. But primarily we'll be dealing with those quadratic equations where a, b, c will be real. Okay. In some cases, we'll also talk about where a, b, c are complex also or non-real also. Okay. There are actually few types or categorizations that we have divided quadratic equation. There's something called pure quadratic. Pure quadratic equation. So what is a pure quadratic equation? It's an equation where b is zero. Okay. Obviously, a should not be zero, but b is zero. C may or may not be zero. Okay. So example of it can be something like x square minus 6 equal to 0. This is an example of pure quadratic equation. When we are doing integration, we'll be learning some integration which involves pure quadratic. Okay. Then the second categorization is something which we call as adfected. Adfected. This word means varying power. Okay. Adfected quadratic equation. In this equation, basically, your b should not be zero, and of course a should not be zero. C may or may not be zero. So a typical example would be something like, you know, x square plus 2x is equal to zero. Okay, this is an adfected quadratic. Okay, then there is a standard quadratic. Okay, standard quadratic, which we are going to talk about. In that, basically we are not going to have your a as zero, rest everything can be zero. So a typical example is like x square plus 3x plus 1. Okay, this is a standard quadratic equation. Okay, now this is not important, just for your know-how. No question will be asked whether which kind of quadratic is it. Okay, so don't get scared. Next important thing when we talk about quadratic is the roots of the quadratic equation. So I'm going to spend quick amount of time on this because in 10th you have done it. I think in the school also you would have done it to a certain extent, and you have been using it also again and again in different verticals. Roots of quadratic equation. How to find roots of quadratic equation? Basically, we'll be talking about the Sridhar Acharya. Sridhar Acharya formula or the quadratic equation formula. Okay. So before that, I like to first start with a quadratic expression. Guys, let me tell you, this is a quadratic expression. It is not an equation. Okay, many people say it's an equation because equal to is involved. This equal to was put only to show that this is plotted against the y-axis. See, it's because you are plotting the values of ax square plus bx plus c on the y-axis. That's why it was called as y. But ideally, it is just an expression, or you can say a polynomial in 2 degrees, or degree 2. Okay. It is equation only when it is equated to some number. Okay. So let's say if I call it as an equation like this, what does it mean? It means that you have equated this with y equal to 0. So if you equate these two graphs, you end up getting this quadratic equation. So don't have a wrong notion about equation. Okay. And there's another wrong notion that I've seen. When I ask people, what is the graph of a quadratic equation? First, say they will make a parabola. Ayo, let me tell you, this is the graph of quadratic expression. This is the graph of y is equal to ax square plus bx plus c. This is not the graph of the equation. The graph of equation doesn't need a y-axis. It is a single variable. It just needs the number line and the two roots of that. Okay. I have tricked many people asking this question. So if somebody says, draw the graph of x square minus 3x plus 2 equal to 0. Okay. Don't start drawing a parabola and all. It just means one and two values. So pick a number line, put a 1, put a 2. This is the graph. Okay. Anyways, my purpose was not to tell you things which is not required right now. But please remember, most of you would be attempting KVPY again. By the way, congratulations to Tripan. In the interview, you may be tricked by asking these things. Okay. Now, with this quadratic expression, I'll be deriving the quadratic equation roots. How will I do that? All of you, please pay attention. So first of all, I will work with y is equal to ax square plus bx plus c. So I'll take an a common. Okay. Just follow the procedure. Right. So basically, I've taken a common from the first two terms. Then I will complete the square over here. Please note, the Sridhar Acharya formula is actually an art of completing square. He did not get this formula by doing tapasya and all. He actually just did completing the square. So it has not come from sky. It has come from a very simple act, and that is the act of completing the square. Okay. Now, if you want to get the roots of this quadratic equation, please pay attention over here, this arrow. If you want to get root of this quadratic equation, you are trying to solve it, or you are trying to see the intersection with y equal to 0. Intersection with y equal to 0, right? Y equal to 0 is what? The x-axis. Okay. So wherever this particular quadratic polynomial will meet the x-axis, those are actually the roots of the quadratic equation, which we normally refer as alpha and beta. Okay. Now see. So if y is 0, I'll put a 0 over here. Okay. So I'll put 0 is equal to a. Okay. And these terms, that is the constant terms over here, I will take it to the left hand side. So b square by 4, let me take LCM also, minus 4ac is equal to a. A I'll drop over here. So a square. So it will become something like this. Okay. Now take the square root. When you take the square root, it becomes x plus b by 2a is equal to plus or minus under root of b square minus 4ac by 4a square. Now, normally in a quadratic equation, you can always choose your a to be positive. You can multiply throughout with a minus 1. So I'm doing that. I'm assuming that I'm making my a positive. So I'll take it out of the root sign and make it 2a. Okay. Else it would have been 2 mod a. Okay. Anyways, so now I'll take the b by 2a to the other side and it becomes minus b plus minus under root b square minus 4ac by 2a. Okay, this is your Sridhar Acharya formula that you had derived. And see, since a is in the denominator, a should not be 0. That's why that condition which I had quoted in the beginning of the discussion, that means a should not be 0. I think it is in the previous page. That is important. Okay, now a couple of things here. So this will correspond to your two roots alpha and beta. So if you take a plus, one root will come. If you take a minus, another root will come. Now there is a relationship between the roots and the coefficients, which you already know. So if you add alpha and beta, you'll get minus b by a. And if you multiply them, you'll get c by a, correct? I'm sure you already know this, okay? There's another way to get to this. If you treat your quadratic to be factorized like this, then you can expand and compare the coefficient. Now, many people ask me, sir, why do you put an a over here? See, if I don't put an a, let me drop an a, okay? Something wrong will occur. So if I drop an a, what will happen? See, so if you're saying this quadratic has two roots, alpha and beta, that means I could equate this to product of these two factors. Now, when you expand it, you end up getting something like this. Okay. Now you can't say that these two expressions are equal because this has an x square and this has an ax square, right? That's why the a over here is important. Okay. So don't forget that a. So now I'm going to get the same relation here by comparing the coefficients. So if you compare the coefficients, let me write here, compare the coefficients. See guys, you also know this, so I'm slightly fast here, okay? But in case you want further discussion, I can always stop and discuss more about it. So this gives you alpha plus beta as minus b by a. And if you compare the constants, c is equal to a alpha beta. So alpha beta will be c by a. Okay? Now, something important. Yes, any question, anybody? Anybody, any question? Vibhav, please mute yourself. Yeah, okay. Now guys, I'm going to get the same thing, that is the condition that you have. Now I'm going to talk about nature of these roots. Nature of these roots. This is also something which is known to you, so I'll be not spending a lot of time. So if you see the Sridhar Acharya formula, the formula was minus b plus minus under root b square minus 4ac by 2a, right? Okay. Now this term over here, which you see under the root, this term is very important. What is this term actually called? This term is actually called the discriminant.
Determinant.
Who said that? It is not determinant, my dear friend. It is discriminant. Okay. Determinant is something else. Now the name discriminant itself means it discriminates. Discriminates between what? It discriminates between the roots, or discriminates between the nature of the roots. Okay. So this term b square minus 4ac is actually called the discriminant, which we also write as d. Okay. Now from this formula, it is very clear that if d is positive, you'll end up getting two values of alpha and beta, which are real and distinct. So here alpha and beta would be two separate values. We say real and distinct. So alpha and beta would be real and distinct. Okay. If d is equal to zero, then alpha and beta would be real and equal. And if d is less than zero, we say alpha beta would be non-real in nature. Okay. Many books call it as imaginary, but it could is just written as non-real in nature. Right? Yes or no? Now, the same thing, I will try to get it from the graph of the parabola. Okay, see how it comes. Now, before that, I would like all of you to answer this question. What happens to the graph when you vary your a? Anybody? What is the change in the shape of the parabola when you vary the A in the given quadratic expression?
So it becomes thinner or fatter.
Thinner or fatter. Very good. Okay. Let me take you to GeoGebra. Students who have not installed GeoGebra yet, my sincere request to you would be, please do so after today's class. Okay, Dhyan says it widens or narrows. Okay. Now that's a very crude way of explaining it. I'll tell you actually what happens. All of you, please focus over here. So y is equal to ax square plus bx plus a c. Okay, now since I have not specified a, b, c, GeoGebra will actually assign some random values to it. That means it will treat it as some parameter, something like this. You can see here. So automatically it has made a, b, c 1, 1, 1. But nevertheless, it has given me an opportunity to vary A from -5 to 5, B also from -5 to 5, C also from -5 to 5. You can always change it. Okay, you can always change it. You can make it, you know, -10 to 10 also. It's your call. Okay, 10 to 10. Okay, with a step off, you can say 0.4. Okay, something like this. It's your call. Okay. Now, guys, all of you, have your eyes glued on this parabola? I'm varying my A. So from a equal to 1, so right now you can see my a value is 1. Okay, check it out. This a value right now is 1. Okay, now I'm going to change this value. I'm going to increase it. Okay, what do you think will happen? Graph will become thinner or fatter? Thinner or fatter? Thinner or fatter? Thinner or fatter? Thinner. Okay, let's check it out. Ooh, correct. Thinner. So I'm increasing the value. See, it's becoming thinner. Okay. As you go lesser, it becomes fatter or it starts expanding. Okay. The moment you become zero, you can see it becomes a straight line. That means the quadratic loses its parabolic structure and it becomes a straight line. Okay. Now, what do you think will happen when I take A as negative? It will bend the other way around. See that? Okay, so from zero, if I go negative, see, it has started bending the other way around. Okay, now this is something which we call as the change in the concavity of the quadratic expression. So A decides the concavity of the parabola. So those who are saying fatter and thinner, this is the technical word. What is the technical word? Concavity. So if it is up, let's say like this, if it is up, it is said to be concave upwards. This is called concave upwards. Okay. Later on, we'll learn this in calculus, that if the graph of a function, let's say there's a function like this. So if your double derivative of this function is always positive, then this graph will be concave upwards. Okay. Don't worry about it right now. We'll talk about this when we deal with the chapters, application of derivatives. Okay. So as you can see, when you double differentiate this quadratic expression, what do you end up getting? See, single differentiation will give you 2ax plus b. Double derivative will give you 2a, correct? And this will always be positive if your a is positive, right? So if your a is positive for all values of x belonging to the domain of this function, that means the graph will open upwards. In a similar way, a function will concave downwards. Okay, concave downwards if the double derivative of the function is always negative for the entire value of the domain. Correct? So if this a becomes negative, then this value will be less than zero, and that is what makes the graph become ulta. Is that fine? Okay. How does B change this graph? Anybody? Or let me ask this question very specifically. You know this point? What is this point called?
Vertex. Of
vertex. Okay, vertex. Okay. Now, how would this vertex change if I change the B value?
Go up or down.
Okay. I want all everybody to give their opinion by typing it up, down, left, right, or it will do some kind of a particular motion. Anybody?
Left, right.
Let's see what is your option. Up, down by Ananya. Aditya motion also says up, down. Okay. Aditi also says up, down. Left, right. Up, down, left, right. Up, down.
Left, right.
Left, right. Okay. All right. So guys, see what is going to happen. First of all, I'll locate this point. By the way, there is a special function available in GeoGebra which tells you the vertex of the conic. Okay. So I can always find the vertex. Okay. Now, I'm going to trace the locus of this point. So I'm going to run show trace. Okay. And I'm going to vary B. What do you see? People were saying up, down, you were partly correct. People were saying right, left, you were also partly correct. It actually traces a parabola itself. See this? If you want, I can increase this interval and show you further. Let's say I put it 15 to 15. Okay. Let's say 0.2. Okay. Let me vary it furthermore. Okay. So it'll again become a parabola only. Okay. Now, this is a question that I would like to give you. If there's a parabola, let's say this parabola, I'll take this parabola 1.6. Okay, let me take some nice value. Okay, 2x square plus bx, okay, plus 3. Okay, this is a quadratic. Fine. If I vary this b, that means b is a parameter. Okay. What is the locus of, sorry, I'm making a locus question here. Okay. What is the locus of the vertex? Okay. This is a question for you, which is for homework. Note this down. You will send this response to me, send the answer to me before you sleep tonight. I think class will end up at 8 o'clock. So before you sleep, you have to send me for this parabola. If I vary the B value, what will be the locus of the vertex? Okay, I will not answer this till I have received response from you guys. You have done so many locus questions. Okay, good. Next question to you all is, how would this vertex change, or how would this parabola change if I vary the C value? Now, please put your response. How will it change when you vary the C value?
Up, down,
up, down, or left, right, or again a parabolic motion.
Up, down.
Ah, this time up, down. Okay, you can see it. You can see it happening now. See the point A. You see that? Okay. So now vertex is tracing a straight line. Okay. Now add one more question. If your C is varying, right? What is the path traced by, what is the equation of that straight line that you see? Okay. Now, anyways, coming back to my previous discussion. So I want all of you to tell me, if this is the parabola or this is the graph of this quadratic polynomial expression, okay, what is the coordinate of the vertex? What is the coordinate of the vertex? So let me draw this. Please note, I have assumed it is concave upwards. That means I have assumed A is zero. But let me tell you, let me assure you that it will not change the coordinates of the vertex. If you don't know the coordinates, I'll help you out. But if you know, can you please type it out?
Could you repeat the question?
That's correct, Shankin. Our question is, in terms of A, B, and C, tell me the coordinates of the vertex of this parabola. Siddharth, that's not correct, dear. Anybody else? Ashankin, is it y is equal to this or x equal to this? It's a line parallel to the y-axis, so it should be x equal to something. No? Yeah, anybody who can tell me the coordinates of the vertex?
1 minute.
Okay. Is it b
if
by...
you're taking 1 minute, then it is as good as me deriving it. So all of you, please pay attention. I would like you all to go to this expression. Sorry, I'm going to the previous board for 1 second. Okay. I would like you all to go to this expression. This expression that you see over here. Oh, sorry, what I'm making. I have to make a box. Yeah, this expression. Okay, I would invite you all to have a look at this expression because I'm going to use this to get the vertex coordinate. So all of you, please copy this down on your notebook. I'm going to the next board. Copied. Okay, now see how I'm going to use that. Okay, so the expression was y is equal to a times x plus b by 2a the whole square minus b square by 4a plus c. This was the expression, correct? Now this is a point where my y is minimum. Do you all agree with this? Vertex is a point where the y is at its least value. There is no other point on the parabola where y is lesser than the y that you have on the vertex in this present scenario. Agreed. So now all of you listen to this. Since your parabola is opening upwards, a is a positive quantity. And since this is a square, this quantity is always greater than or equal to zero. And this quantity here is fixed. Now, boys and girls, think about it carefully and then respond. If you want your y to be minimum, what should happen to... So a cannot change. This fixed quantity cannot change. What should happen to this fellow? If you want your y to be minimum, this has to be minimum, then what should be the value of the square thingy? Zero. Very good, Sudha. Very good, Arpita. Very good. Very good. So if that is zero, my dear friend, you would agree that x has to take this value. Right? Only under this condition, my y will become minimum. So your x coordinate of this point should be minus b by 2a. Do you agree? And if your this term becomes zero, then your y minimum would be, let me write it over here, your y minimum would be negative b square by 4a plus c, which is actually negative of b square minus 4ac by 4a, which is actually minus d by 4a. So in future, please remember this expression. I would not derive this again and again. So please remember this. Okay. Sorry, I'm asking you to memorize something, but it's only for your good. Now, sir, partial derivative gives you the center, Pratham. It doesn't give you the vertex. Partial derivative gives you the center of the conic. It doesn't give you the vertex of the conic. Got it? Okay. Sure, Anita, I'll go through it once again. So, Anita, remember in the previous board, I had come from this expression to this expression by completing square, correct? Now, my aim here is, my problem statement is, I want to get the coordinates of this point. I want to get the coordinates of the vertex, okay? Now, vertex is a point where your y is minimum, correct? Now, when can this expression become a minimum? Now, let me tell you the ingredients of this expression. It has an a value in it, which is always positive, but however fixed for that particular expression. There is a variable quantity, but since it is subjected to a square, it is always greater than or equal to zero. And there's another fixed quantity, that is b square by 4a plus c, minus b square by 4a plus c. Now, if you want your y to become least, as less as possible, right? Can I say this positive thing should be as less as possible? And for that, this quantity which is greater than or equal to zero should actually become a zero. Correct or no? Anita, correct? So if it actually becomes a zero, it can only happen when x becomes minus b by 2a, right? Then only your y will take this value, which is minus d by 4a. So the point where your y is minimum will actually have this as your coordinate. Okay. Now all of you, please pay attention here. Now, by using this vertex, By using this vertex, I will get the condition for the nature of the roots. All of you, please see this. Again, I am sketching the graph of the parabola. Okay. So this is your parabola. This coordinate was minus b by 2a, comma minus d by 4a. Okay. Now let me assume a scenario here that a is positive. Okay. Now, if your roots are real and distinct, if your alpha and beta are real and distinct, think carefully and answer. What should be the y coordinate of the vertex? Should it be negative or should it be positive or should it be zero? I'm repeating my question. If you want your roots to be real and distinct, like what I have shown in the diagram, should the y coordinate of the vertex be positive, negative, or zero?
Negative.
Negative, very obvious from the diagram. So if it is negative, my dear, you would agree that this y coordinate, which is minus d by 4a, should have negative value. Correct? Now, let me take the 4a on top, which means minus d should be negative value. Remember, inequality will not change because 4a is positive. Okay. That means d should be positive. Correct? Multiply throughout with minus 1, inequality will flip. Isn't this the condition that we had derived in the earlier page also by using the Sridhar Acharya formula? Now see, I'm bringing the same concept to you on the table, but from a different angle, from a different perspective. Are you getting my point? Are you getting this point? If you want your alpha and beta to be real and equal, okay, now watch the diagram. How will it change if you want your alpha and beta to become the same value? Can I say it would be a condition where the graph is just touching the x-axis? Okay, now the alpha and beta will come to the same point. Okay, this will happen when the y coordinate exactly becomes zero. That means d is equal to zero. The same condition for real and equal roots. Now I'm deriving it from a different angle. If you want your alpha and beta to be non-real or imaginary, what will happen to this graph? It should be hanging in the air like this, something like this, correct? If it is hanging, there will be no real roots being created. Okay. In that case, minus d by 4a should be positive. That means minus d should be positive. That means d should be negative. The same condition. Getting my point? Getting my point? Now, many people ask, sir, will the same condition hold true if your parabola was opening downwards? Yes, it will not change. So, I will just do one of it and leave the rest up to you to realize for homework. If your parabola was having concave downwards position like this, and let's say this was your alpha beta. Okay. Now tell me, what is the vertex coordinate? Now again, I'll leave this as an exercise. It will remain the same. Hint is now you should search for, see, I'm so patriotic. For hint, I've written hint. Okay. So for the vertex, now you should be looking out for y max. Okay. Trust me, the vertex coordinate doesn't change. Okay. Now, if you want your roots to be real and distinct, if you want it to be real and distinct, what should be your y coordinate? Oh, sorry. Minus b by 2a. It doesn't change. Yeah. Sorry, by mistake I wrote. Thank you, Sahana. Thank you. Yeah. If you want your roots to be real and distinct, what can you comment about the y coordinate of the vertex? Shouldn't it be positive?
Greater than zero.
Correct. Now, since a is negative over here, guys, let me tell you, it's a downward opening parabola. So if a is negative and if I take the a on the other side, won't this switch the inequality sign? Correct? And if you drop your minus sign, again the inequality sign will be switched. That means the condition doesn't change. Condition of the nature doesn't change irrespective of whether your parabola is opening upward or opening downward. Is that clear? Is that clear, everybody? Okay. Now, this can also help us to know the sign of a quadratic expression. So I'll take this as a next concept, sign of a quadratic expression. Okay. Normally, a lot of questions are based on this. So a quadratic expression like this. Okay. This is an expression, not an equation. Okay. When will it always be positive? Can somebody tell me? When will this be always be positive? That means it is greater than zero for all values of x. Can somebody tell me from the previous exercise that we had, what are the conditions that I need to honor such that this quadratic will always be positive no matter whatever x you feed in?
A should be positive.
Okay.
D should be less than zero.
Awesome. Very good, guys. This is the condition which we need to honor for this quadratic expression to be always positive. Now, question is why? Okay, now why A should be A should be positive. Yeah, why A should be positive? See, if A is negative, your quadratic will be facing downwards. Okay, so I'm just drawing a rough figure. So if you have a quadratic like this, let me tell you, these are infinitely extending arms. They will both go to minus infinity. Okay. You cannot stop the parabola from acquiring negative values. So A must never be negative. Right? Now, if A is positive, why do we want our D to be negative? Because if A is positive and it is like this, then what will happen? For these values of X, your graph here is negative, isn't it? So it will not be always be positive. Right? So if you want this to be always positive, the ideal situation is it should be hanging in the air like this. That means your Y, let me call this as Y, even though I don't want to write it. So I'm just putting brackets. So let's say you're calling it as Y. Y should always be positive. That means your graph should be entirely above the x-axis. For that, you should have imaginary roots, or you should not have any real roots. So that's why this condition, that is your second condition, must be true. Okay. Now, carrying on with the same discussion, if you want your quadratic expression to be always negative for all values of x, then what are the conditions we need to honor? Think and tell me carefully. I'm putting a box for you to tell me the answer. You can type it out. If you don't want to speak, you can type it out.
A less than zero and D less than zero.
A less than zero, D also less than zero. Very good. So that means it should be hanging down like this. Okay, so this is a scenario where it will have always a negative value. Very good, Vibhav. Aditya, D should be negative, not positive. Okay. Fine. Now, before we solve any question, I would like you to know these properties. Properties of the roots of a quadratic. Of a quadratic equation. Okay. So let us say I have a quadratic equation like this. Okay. Now, these are the properties which you must note. Very important. Number one, if your ABC, that is the coefficients that you see over here, if they are all real, if ABC are all real, and one of the roots, is imaginary, that is P plus IQ. Okay. Then this property says that the other root will be P minus IQ. That means it would be its complex conjugate. Okay. Please remember, this property will only hold good if your A, B, C are all real. If let's say any one of them is non-real, that means if let's say A is a imaginary number, let's say 2 plus 3i, then will you apply this property? No. It is only applied when your coefficients are all real. Then you can say if one of the root is imaginary like P plus IQ, the other must be of the type P minus IQ. Is that fine? Okay. Also note, my dear students, that this is applicable to polynomial equation of any degree. Polynomial equation of any degree. That means if you have a polynomial equation whose coefficients are all real, and if let's say any one of the root becomes P plus IQ, then P minus IQ must also be present. That means they will always come in pairs. They will always come in pairs. Are you getting my point? Okay. Next property. Yeah. Any question, anybody? Yes. Sure. I'll repeat it again, Dhyan. See, if any polynomial equation, no matter whatever is the degree, if let's say one of the root is imaginary in nature, then its conjugate root must also be a root of the same equation. Okay, a simple example is, let's say x cube minus 1 equal to 0. Okay, so this has three roots, 1, minus half plus I root 3 by 2, and minus half minus I root 3 by 2. So this is a cubic equation. This is a cubic polynomial equation, isn't it? This is a cubic polynomial equation. Okay. As you can see, one of the roots is of the nature P plus IQ, then the other must be of the nature P minus IQ. Correct? So they will always come in pairs. Sir, it's not possible to have one root real and other root imaginary if A, B, C are... See, Vibhav, imaginary roots, when your coefficients are real, will always come in pairs. It will not come in isolation. So it can never happen that you have two real root and one imaginary root. If you have ABC as real, please note that I'm repeating this again and again. Okay. So exactly if there is a quadratic, we cannot have one real and one imaginary. Never it will happen. If your ABC are real. Okay. By the way, what is this called, guys? What is this?
Omega.
Omega, and this is omega square. Okay, good. Next property, that is property number two. Property number two says, if A, B, C are rational. Okay, now I'm changing the coefficient to rational. Okay. And if one of the roots of the quadratic, is P plus root Q. That means it is irrational. That means, let's say it belongs to Q bar. Bar means not a rational. Okay. Then the other root must be P minus root Q. That means it is going to be its rational conjugate. It's going to be its rational conjugate. Okay. So if one root is, let's say, 2 plus root 3, other will be 2 minus root 3. If one root is, let's say, 5 minus root 6, the other will be 5 plus root 6. Okay? But guys, unfortunately, this property is not applicable for all polynomial equations. For some it works, for some it does not. Okay? Now, this is a shocking thing for many of you, because in R.S. Agarwal polynomial equation, it was stated that if one root is 2 plus root 3, other has to be 2 minus root 3, irrespective of whether it's quadratic or cubic or biquadratic or pentic. Let me tell you, this is not true. This is not true. I'll give you a classic example for this, which will come across in many books also. Take this equation. X cube minus 3x plus 1 equal to 0. X cube minus 3x plus 1 equal to 0. Okay. How many roots it should have? 3 roots. Okay. Now my claim is that the irrational roots will not exist in pairs. So there's no pairing, just like we have it for complex. Complex mein there will always be pairing. But in case of rational, irrational roots, this pairing is not a must. It is not compulsory. Okay. Now, later on when I'm doing the solving of cubic polynomial, I'll be discussing a method called Cardan's method with you. Cardan's method. Okay. I'll be telling you how to solve cubic equation. Just like you know how to solve quadratic equation. Okay. Later on I'll tell you, if you apply Cardan's method, you will get the roots of this as, the roots of this as 2 cos 40 degree, 2 cos 80 degree, and 2 cos 160 degree. Okay. Those who have calculators or phones in front of you, can you quickly tell me what are these values? Okay. Please tell me these values. Anybody?
Two cos 40 is 1.53.
Okay.
Two cos 80 is 0.34.
Two cos 80 is 0.347, right?
Yes.
Yeah. Then what is this?
Minus 1.879.
So let's say 1.88. Okay. Now even though they look like rational numbers, they are not actually. Okay. Now, my bottle just fell. Okay, sorry. Yeah. Now, these quantities that you see here, okay, these are all irrational values. Now, many people even question me on this. How do you know that these are irrational values? How do you know that you cannot express them as P by Q? Okay. Now, to support this, there is a theorem which we call as Niven's theorem. Niven's theorem. Okay. You can do a quick study on this after the class. Niven's theorem says that if theta is rational and belongs to 0 to 90 degrees, okay, then only the following angles theta will give you rational values of sine theta. So this will be rational only for these three angles, 0 degree, 30 degree, 90 degree. And similarly, cos theta would be rational only for theta equal to 0 degree, 60 degree, and 90 degree. That means other than 0, half, and 1, there is no angle which is rational for which sine is going to give you a rational output. This is Niven's theorem. Okay. Now, cos 40 doesn't belong to this. Right? 40 doesn't belong to this angle. 80 also doesn't belong to this angle. In fact, cos 60, you can directly write it as negative 2 cos 20. Okay. So, even cos 20 doesn't belong to this angle. So, cos theta for these angles, which is 40, 80, and 160, will be irrational. Okay. 37 is 37 not a rational value, Shaumik? 37 degree, are you sure it gives exactly the same value? No, it is an approximation. 37 is an approximation. Getting the point? Okay, so now these three are irrational, and it is actually surprising because if they are irrational, they should have existed in pairs. But all the three are irrational. All the three roots are irrational. So where is the question of a pair getting formed over here? So even if you form a pair between the two of them, the third one is without a pair. Are you getting my point? So it is not necessary that your irrational roots will exist in pairs. It is true for quadratic. I agree with that. It is true for a quadratic, but it is not true for any polynomial. Okay. And those of you who are wondering how are these the roots, I'll quickly show you on the GeoGebra. I don't want you to sit in confusion here. So I'll just delete it. Delete it. Delete it. Okay. So the equation was y is equal to x cube minus 3x plus 1. Okay. Oh, this is already some. Okay, let me open a new one. Don't save. Okay. Yeah. So y is equal to x cube minus 3x plus 1. Okay. I can show you the roots over here. By the way, you can also solve. There is a function in GeoGebra which says solve. Solve and you press the function name. Okay. Yeah, sorry. As you can see here, it is showing you the three roots. Minus 1.88, minus 0.35 and 1.53. Is that understood? So there is a condition where I had a cubic polynomial equation which doesn't give me rational roots or irrational roots in pairs. Yeah, you can extend it to tan also, right? You can extend it to tan also. Okay, so I would suggest you to go through Niven's theorem after the class. Okay.
Sir?
Well done. Yeah, tell me.
Sir, but if one of the roots, like we can't have just one irrational root. Sir.
No, all the three are irrational over here.
Yes, sir. But is it possible to have just one irrational root and the other two are rational?
Now with this, I'm sure it should be possible also.
Sir, but then
there's one irrational. I've seen a case where there was a pentic equation. Pentic means degree 5, where there was two pairs of complex and one was irrational. Like that I've seen.
Sir, but then like if one is irrational, the other two are rational, then if we add the coefficients, it won't give a rational value. But then the second coefficient, the coefficient of x square should be, it should be rational, right?
In this
because
case,
the sum of the roots is the coefficient of x square.
See, in this case, it is happening that there are three of irrational roots, but you are claiming that only one irrational root, right?
Yes, sir. I'm asking if that's possible.
I have to think of a condition right now. It may not strike me. But prima facie, it appears that there may be a situation where there is just one irrational roots and the other two, you are saying, have to be real?
Yes, sir. Both should be irrational, rational.
No, one is irrational, other two, rational.
Rational. Yes.
No, in that case, it cannot happen.
That's not possible, sir. Yeah.
Now, let us take the next property. So, I'm switching the board. Okay. This is a property which has come up from a lot of questions which have come in JEE in the previous years. The property says, if there are two quadratics, let's say this and this. Okay. And let's say the discriminant of this is D1 and discriminant of this is D2. Okay. So this property says if your D1 plus D2 is positive or greater than or equal to zero, then at least one of the quadratic, at least one of the quadratic will have real roots. Now, this is a very trivial thing because if the sum of two things is positive, then at least one of them should be positive. Correct? So, both positive means both will have real roots. So, this will still be holding true. But if let's say one is negative, then the other has to be definitely be positive to make the overall sum positive. Okay? So, this is something which is a very trivial kind of observation and a lot of questions have come on this in the past. That's why I'm putting this as a property. if the sum of the discriminants is negative, then remember at least one of them will have non-real roots. At least one of the quadratic has non-real roots or imaginary roots. Yes. Any questions? Okay. Are we good to go? Are we good to start solving questions? Okay, so here is the first question for all of you. I'll start with a very basic question. This one. Solve for x. So Dauta, is that the complete solution or there can be still further values? I want the exhaustive solution. Okay, Shristi. Okay, Aditya, Sudha. Guys, last 1 minute. Okay, Ayush. All right, guys, time up. Let's discuss. Most of you have given incomplete answers. Incomplete answer means there are more solutions possible. Now, all of you, please focus over here. We know that 5 plus 2 root 6 and 5 minus 2 root 6 will actually give you a 1, right? 25 minus 24. That means 5 minus 2 root 6 is actually reciprocal of 5 plus 2 root 6. Or you can say 5 plus 2 root 6 to the power of minus 1, right? So if I do this activity, that means if I raise the left hand side to this, here I will realize I'm actually doing 1 by 5 plus 2 root 6 to the power of x square minus 3. Correct? Now, let us call 5 plus 2 root 6 to the power of x square minus 3 as t. Okay? This is called convertible to quadratic. So it will become t plus 1 by t. Remember, this term is actually 1 by this expression. So I'm calling it as 1 by t. Right? So here you have a quadratic in front of you, which you can easily solve. T square minus 10t plus 1 equal to 0. Let's use our Sridhar Acharya formula for this. B square minus 4ac by 2a. That is nothing but 10 plus minus root 96 by 2. Root 96 is 4 root 6. So 2 factor will get cancelled. So it will be this. Okay. That means 5 plus 2 root 6 to the power of x square minus 3 is either 5 plus 2 root 6 or it is 5 minus 2 root 6, correct? Now this implies that x square minus 3 has to be 1, and this implies x square minus 3 has to be minus 1. Now most of you gave me the response 2 and minus 2 because you only ended up solving this. You didn't care about the other one. So if you solve this one, you get x square is equal to 2. That means x will be plus or minus root 2. So there are four solutions possible. That is 2, minus 2, plus root 2, minus root 2. Is that fine? Did you realize your mistake where you left off one of the equations? So guys, something to make you happy. Let's have a break. Okay. It's only 2 hours of class. I'm sure you must be hungry. We'll resume at 6:21 PM. Okay. So this is a multi-correct question. I would request you all to type out the answer individually, privately to me. It's a multi-correct question. Read the question carefully. It says, the roots of this equation are non-real complex and a plus c is less than b. Then which of the following options are correct? Let's have 3 minutes for this. Time starts now. Yes, any success, anybody? Okay, Aditi says, okay, I'll not disclose her answer. It's multi-correct, Aditi, so there can be more than one options correct also. So just look at all the options and be doubly sure before answering. is last 1 minute I can give you. Already 3 minutes have passed. Okay, Kirtana, good. I'm not saying right or wrong to your answer. We'll discuss it in some time. Okay, Aditya. Okay, Dhyan. Okay, Arpita. Mm-hmm. Guys, last 20 seconds. Okay, Krishna. Okay, Siddharth. Okay. Good. Let's discuss this and then we'll come back who has given the right answers. Okay. So your answers are in front of me. So first of all, this is a quadratic expression which has got non-real roots, right? Non-real root means, non-real roots means the graph is either hanging in the air above the x-axis or below the x-axis. So it could be either be a situation like this, okay? Or it could be a situation like this. So I'm just drawing, you know, two possibilities, correct? So white one is a situation where your A is positive and green, yellow one is a situation where your A is negative. Okay. Now all of you, please look at this expression. A plus C less than B. Okay. It is actually saying A minus B plus C is less than zero. Correct? Now let me call this expression as f of x. So let's say I call f of x as ax squared plus bx plus c, right? If I want to get this, tell me which value should I put as x? Minus one, absolutely. So if I put a minus one, this is what I'll get. Now, what is the question saying? This is less than zero. That means the value of the function or the y coordinate of the point whose x coordinate is minus one is negative. That means, let's say this x coordinate is minus one. So my y coordinate for the same point is a negative value. Okay. It can only happen when your graph is this one and not this one. Because for this at minus one, your value should have been a positive value, isn't it? But this is clearly saying it is negative. Negative means it is a downward opening parabola. And not only that, it doesn't have any roots. Okay. So if A is negative and D is negative, that means, remember the sign of the quadratic expression that we were discussing? This is always going to be negative. Correct? Now, look at the options. If you see this option, I'm going to use a different color. If you see this option, this is like saying 4a minus 2b plus c is greater than 0. Okay. That means indirectly it's trying to say f of minus 2 is greater than 0. Do you think it is correct? See, the property says the quadratic must always be less than 0 because these two conditions are satisfied. So can this ever happen?
No.
It will never happen. So option A is wrong. So sorry to those people who have marked option A in their answer, that is wrong. But can option B happen? Yes, because it is saying f of minus 2 is less than 0. That is possible. So B is possible. Okay. Now look at this. Okay. It is as good as saying, A by 4 minus B by 2. Let me raise this. A by 4 minus B by 2 plus C is greater than 0, right? If you just divide by 4 throughout and bring the B to the left hand side, this is what it's trying to say. Isn't it like F of minus half? They're saying F of minus half is greater than 0. But please note, this condition must be holding for all values of X. So even C is wrong. And by the same reason, D is correct. So the right options here are B and D. These are your correct options. Let's see who all gave the right answer. Okay, Arpita is asking, how did you get this as a downward opening parabola? Arpita, this is a condition which says f of minus 1 is negative, right? F of minus 1 means the value of the function at minus 1 should be a negative value. So at minus 1, if you go up, you will get a positive value, right? That means this graph is not possible. Only the downward graph will give me a negative value. That's why a downward opening parabola would be there. Okay. So Ajay, incomplete answer. Areman, one correct, one wrong. Anjali, wrong. Shomik, wrong. Krishna, wrong. Siddharth, wrong. Sudha, wrong. Arpita, wrong. Aditya, wrong. Kirtana, that's correct. Kirtana is the only one person who gave this correctly. Well done. Next question. Okay. So this is a single option correct question. And I would run a poll for you all. Okay. Let's have 3 minutes to do this. Okay, I got one response. Guys, last 30 seconds. Make sure everybody should. Poll or go for the poll. Okay, the countdown has begun. Last 10 seconds. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Press on the poll button, guys, everyone. Okay. Let's stop. Oh my God, if such a response were given in KBC, the person sitting on the hot seat. My God, equal vote for B, C, D. And just by marginal, A is more. Okay, let's check whether Janta is correct or not. Okay, Shamik, let's check. Okay. First of all, if you see the given situation, you would realize A is negative, right? For sure. Because it's a downward opening parabola. Concavity is downward. Correct? Second thing you would realize that this value is actually your 0, C. Let me use a 0, C. So C must be positive. So product of AC should be negative for sure. That means C cannot be correct. I don't know why you people voted for C. Even a 10th grader can see that C is not correct. Okay. Okay, next thing is, if you see alpha value is lesser than minus one and beta value is greater than one, you can see the position of one and minus one, okay? So the product of the roots, that is alpha beta, should be definitely be less than minus one. You can assume some value. Let's say if you take this value as minus two and if you take this value as two, then product is minus four, right? Minus four is definitely less than minus one, which means C by A should be less than minus one. So that means D must be also be wrong. I don't know why you voted for D. Okay, next thing. Let's see this one. When X is greater than beta, your function is acquiring positive value, which is clearly not correct. Because if you take a beta value, higher beta value, higher than beta value, let's say I take gamma, your function is acquiring a negative value here. So this is also not correct, which only leaves you with A as correct answer, but still I'll justify this. All of you, please pay attention. What is mod of beta minus alpha indicate here? Mod of beta minus alpha actually indicates the distance between this position to this position. So this distance here is mod of beta minus alpha. Correct? Can I say that is definitely going to be greater than 2? Because this distance itself is 2. Correct? Yes or no? And C by A is a value which is less than equal to 1. Sorry, less than minus 1. Okay. So if you multiply it, you'll end up getting something which is less than minus 2, which is actually what option A says. Okay. Guys, I can see people are making mistakes in obvious things. Okay, let's have another question. Okay, let's have this one. This is a very interesting one. Again, multiple options may be correct. Time starts now.
Sir, single option or multiple option?
It's multiple option. I already told you it's a multi option. Multiple options may be correct. Can you do one thing? Instead of giving you a straightforward 4 minutes to do this, can we have 1 minute for each one of them? Let's have the first one. Is this option correct or wrong? Just type. Okay, let's say A is correct and B is for incorrect. Okay, I'm running a poll. All of you please comment about the first one. Okay. Let me run a poll. It will be interesting to see how you guys are responding to that. Okay, let's have a minute for that. Press A if you think A is correct. Press B if you think A is wrong. Just 1 minute I'll give you, not more than that. Guys, fast. Yeah, press on the poll button also. Those who are responding to me privately, press on the poll button also. Okay, time up. See the poll result. Most of you said A is correct. 58% of you have said A is correct. Let's check everyone. Now, if you see this expression, it is actually trying to say, this expression is always less than or equal to zero. The probability of it is happening is 0.3. Okay. And your x can only take first 100 natural numbers. So your x should only come from 1 to 100. Okay, let's check. I'm sure this is factorizable, right? Yeah, 30 and 5. So x minus 30. So x plus 5, x minus 30. Okay. So we all know these inequalities that it will be true only when x lies between minus 5 to 30. Okay. Now minus 5 to 30, the favorable conditions would be only when it takes 1 to 30 because it cannot go to the negative side because we are only allowed to choose natural numbers. Okay. So my favorable condition will only be 30, which is 1 to 30, and my total sample space is 100. So I can say my probability is going to be 30 by 100, which is 0.3. So yes, you guys are correct. A is right. Okay. Now I'm running a poll for B option. And likewise, you have to choose A and B. A for correct, B for wrong. Okay. 1 minute for that. A for correct, B for wrong. Okay, Shomik. Press on the poll button, A for correct, B for wrong. Yeah. Yes, Krishna, A for correct, B for wrong. All right, end of poll. Maximum people have said, 88% of you have said B option is wrong. Let's check it out. Let's check it out. Now, you want this expression to be greater than equal to zero, right? So let me write it over here. Let me put a demarcation here. So x square minus 17x plus 30 is greater than or equal to zero. That means I'm sure it is factorizable. Minus 15x minus 2x plus 30 greater than or equal to zero. That means x minus 15, x minus 2 greater than or equal to zero. That means x should be either be less than or equal to 2 or x should be greater than or equal to 15. Now let us count the favorable events. How many natural numbers are less than or equal to 2? One only, oh sorry, two. Two itself is included. So one and two. How many numbers from 15 onwards till 100? So how many natural numbers are from 15 to 100? 86. Including 15 and 100, 86. So total will be 88. So probability would be 88 by 100. That's 0.88. So option B also is correct, my dear. So Janta was wrong. Guys, I don't see a point to make a mistake here. What happened? People went wrong for this on a massive scale. 88% people gave a wrong answer. Yeah, sure. Why not? Yeah. Is that fine, Dhyan? Why people went wrong in this? See, follow this. A is correct, B is wrong, okay? Okay. Now, let's have the response for C. Again, the same thing. You have to press A if it is correct. And press B if it is not. Poll starts now. Oh, 100 minus 15 is 75, but you have to add a 1 also because corner positions are also included. Guys, you can take a little longer time for this. Probably you can take one more minute. No worries. Okay, countdown begins. Last 10 seconds, please press on the poll button. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, go. Everyone. Okay, end of poll. Look at the results. Maximum of you have said C option is wrong. 63% of you have said C option is wrong. Hey, who is pressing C? Yeah? You have to only press A and B, okay? Yeah. Let us discuss it. Let us discuss this. X square minus, 30x minus x square is a perfect square. The probability of it is 0.07. Okay, let's do this thing. Again, let me draw a line over here. 30x minus x square, let's say it's a perfect square, which is, let's say, a square. Okay. Now, if this is a perfect square, by the way, this can be computed to be 15 square minus 15 minus x the whole square, isn't it? Am I right? I have tried to compute a perfect square from the left hand side like this. Am I correct? Okay. So I can write 15 minus x the whole square to be 15 square minus a square. Or you can write it as 15 minus a into 15 plus a. Okay. Now, please note, since there is a 15 minus a, I can only go from 1 to 15. So a can go from 1 to 15. Okay. We have to do this manually now. Now put a as 1. If you put a as 1, you get 15 minus x the whole square as. Okay. By the way, can you put a 0 first? Yeah, 0 is also permissible, right? Yeah. If you put a 0, I'll end up getting 15 square. Right? That gives me two values of x. One is 0 and the other is 30. Okay? So one value I have over here, 30 is going to give me a perfect square. You can check. This is going to become a 0 for that. 0 is itself a perfect square. So one solution I get from here. Now, if I put a as 1, so this is when your a is 0. If I put a as 1, what do I get? What do I get? I get 15 minus x square as 14 into 16. No, I don't think so. This is square of something. Okay. So I'll get no solutions from here. Okay. Let's try out the other values. I'm writing it over here once again. 15 minus x the whole square. 15 minus x the whole square is equal to 15 plus a. Okay. Does a equal to 3 work? Check. 12 into 18, is it a perfect square? 12 into 18, is it a perfect square? 216, no, it is not a perfect square. Okay. A equal to 4, will it work? Check. 11 into 19, that is also not a perfect square, it will also not work. A equal to 5. 10 into 20, it will also not work. A equal to 6. 6 gives you 9 into 21. That is 189. That will also not work. A equal to 7. 8 into 22. That will also not work. A equal to 8. That will give you 7 into 23. That will also not work. A equal to 9. That will give you 6 into 24. That is 144. Yes, it is 12 square. So A equal to 9 will work. And for that, I'll get two values. One is plus 12. So 15 minus x is plus 12 and 15 minus x is minus 12. And both of them will give me two values. So one will be 3, other will be 27. Okay. Now let's carry on. 10. 10 will give me 25 into 5. Correct? 25 into 5. 125. 125 is not a perfect square. Okay, a equal to 11, it'll give me 4 into 26. Again, it's a perfect square. 4 into 26 is, no, 4 into 26 is 8. Oh, sorry. This is not a perfect square. It is 104. So this will also not work. Sorry. A equal to 12. will give me 3 into 27. 81. Yes, it will work. So 15 minus x, the whole square could be plus minus 9. So one of the values could be 24. And other value could be 6. Okay. A equal to 13. No, it will not work. 2 into 28. A equal to 14. No, it will not work. A equal to 15. I think 15 we have already seen when we had put. 15 will give you 0. So x can be 15. Correct? Yes or no? So what are the values that we have got? 30, 3, 27, 24, 6, 15. Anything else that I am missing out on? I cannot go higher than 15 for A, right? Because one of them will become negative.
So what about A equal to 2?
A equal to 2 gives you 13 into 18, 13 into 17. Is that a perfect square?
No.
Didn't I take that up? No, I took this up. No. Oh no, I didn't take up. A equal to 2 will give me this as 13 into 17. This is not a perfect square. Yeah. Anything else that I'm missing out? So guys, the answer is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 by 100, 0.06, which unfortunately is not there because it is 0.07, so C is wrong. Okay?
So?
Yes.
So can we say that if it should be a perfect square, then it should have equal roots?
See, if you say it has equal roots, x may be not between 1 to 100 also. So many other values will come into picture.
Okay.
Sir. Okay. And if it is equal roots, that will definitely be satisfied. See, this cannot have equal roots because if you say this, it is actually 30 minus x into x. The roots are clear. The roots are 0 or 30. They cannot be equal. I understand where you're coming from. You're coming from the straight lines concept, right?
Yes, sir.
No, that was expression which was supposed to be a perfect square. Here it is the value that we are talking about. Okay?
Okay.
Last one. Let's run the poll for the last one. Again, sorry. Stop sharing. Again, A for correct, B for wrong. 1 minute for this. Last 10 seconds, guys. Time starts now. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Please press on the poll button. Okay, I don't know why people are voting for D. Only A and B have to be voted for. Okay. Now, maximum people say it's correct. Okay, let's check. So you're saying 30 minus x square is less than 0. The probability for that to happen is 0.7. So I'll use this space. 30x minus x square is less than 0. Means you're trying to say x square minus 30x is greater than 0. That means x could either be less than 0 or x could be greater than 30. Greater than 30 means from 31 to 100 we have to count. 31 to 100 there are 70 values including the corner values. So answer will be 70 by 100 which is 0.7. So yes, you are correct. Janta was correct. D is correct. So A, C and A, B and D are the right options. Very good guys. Interesting question, isn't it? So a bit of probability also getting tested. Okay. Let's have another question. Okay, let's move on to another a property question. I'll just take it up from So it's a show that question. Show that if P, Q, R, S are real and PR is equal to twice of Q plus S, then at least one of the equation has real roots. We have already done a property based on this. So try to apply that. I'll give you 2 minutes for this, not more than that. Done, Pratham, Vivek, okay, good. Okay, let's discuss, guys. This is a very easy question. See, if you look at the first quadratic, let's say this one. Okay. So for this quadratic, let's say your discriminant is D1. Okay. And D1 would be P square minus 4Q. Okay. Let's look into the other quadratic. For this, the discriminant is R square minus 4S. Now let us add these two discriminants. If you add this, it actually becomes P square plus Q square minus 4Q plus S. Okay. Now time to utilize this condition that we have. PR is equal to twice of Q plus S. So can I say 4Q plus S could be written as 2PR? Okay. So from the condition given to us, that is PR is equal to 2Q plus S, I can write this as D1 plus D2 equal to P square plus R square minus 2PR. Isn't this P minus R the whole square? Which means it is definitely greater than or equal to zero. Correct? Now remember the property which I told you, if D1 plus D2 is greater than or equal to zero, that implies at least one of D1 or D2, at least one of D1 and D2 must be greater than or equal to zero. That means at least one equation must have real roots. Is that fine? Easy? Everybody could do this? Any questions? Good. Guys, the next concept which I'm going to talk about is very important. I would like all of you to pay attention here. That concept is called the transformation of quadratic equations. Now, even though I'm writing quadratic equations here, it could be applied to other polynomial equations also. Okay, so let's talk about this concept. Okay. I have a question for you in general. Let's say we have ax square plus bx plus c equal to 0 as a quadratic whose roots are alpha and beta. Okay. Now we all know that alpha plus beta is minus b by a and alpha into beta is c by a. Right? Everybody knows this. Okay. I'll talk about this also in detail. This is something which we call as beta's relation. Beta's relation after the name of the Italian mathematician. Now I don't know what you're thinking when you hear of Italy. Okay, anyways, let's not talk about Corona now. Enough messages I'm getting, man, on Corona and all those things. Fed up. Aren't you all getting messages on Corona? Too much of discussion going on, right? Okay. So let's say the roots of this quadratic equation are alpha and beta. I have a question here for everybody. Tell me a quadratic whose roots are, let's say, 3 alpha by alpha plus 2 and 3 beta by beta plus 2. How do you solve such questions? Normally, what is the approach when you solve these questions? Anybody can unmute himself or herself and say, what approach normally do you take when you're solving these questions? Anybody? Aditya, my question is, tell me a quadratic whose roots are these two. If this quadratic has roots alpha, beta, tell me a quadratic whose roots are these two.
Add and multiply and put in the place of b and c.
Right. Very good. Very good. So people do this. Let's say I call this gamma and delta. They get this equation by doing this activity, x square minus gamma plus delta x plus gamma delta, right? This is what you do. Okay. For that, you have to find the sum and you have to find the product. Okay. Now I'm going to tell you an approach. Yeah, correct, Krishna. Correct. Now I'm going to tell you an approach which will not require you to find the sum and the product. And that approach is the transformation of equation. So all of you, please listen to this very, very carefully. Transformation of equation is applied when you already know a root of a certain equation and you want to find out an equation whose roots are a symmetrical change in both these roots. So you can see there is a symmetrical change happening in both these roots. That means both of them are undergoing a similar fate. In fact, the same fate. Do you realize? Here, 3 alpha, alpha plus 2, 3 beta, beta plus 2. So wherever you realize that your roots are getting transformed under the same function, then this method, which I'm going to tell you next, is going to be very, very handy. Okay. But however, it has a limitation. It only will work for those situations where both the roots are undergoing the same fate. Okay, so this method is useful only when, what happened to my, just a second. What happened to this color, man? Are you able to see this?
No, sir.
Okay, just let me do one thing. Let me. What has happened? Yeah, here it is working. I don't know why it's not working on the previous board. Let me choose some different color. Okay, let me just scroll this up or down. Okay, I think it's getting hanged. Okay, so let me do one thing. Let me save this document because probably we'll lose out the details over here. So let me write it as theory of equations. For NPS RNR. I'm just going to reopen this again because there is some issue with this thing. Okay, let me go to the next page. Okay, so now let's say you want 3 alpha and alpha plus 2 and 3 beta, beta plus 2 as your new roots of an equation, correct? Now what I do here, all of you please watch carefully. Since alpha is a root of ax square plus bx plus c equal to 0, can I say alpha will satisfy this equation? Correct? Let me call this as 1. Okay? Now you want to construct an equation whose roots are these two fellows. So let me do one thing. Let me call this as x. Okay? And now what I'll do is, from this expression, I will make alpha the subject of the formula. So let me cross multiply. And let me do this. So alpha will become 2x by 3 minus x. Okay, let me call this as 2. Okay, now this 2 you substitute in 1. That means in place of alpha that you have written over here, you substitute this guy, 2x by 3 minus x. So it becomes something like this. Okay. And now you simplify this expression to bring it to another quadratic. That quadratic will be your answer. Okay. So this is how we work on those questions where there is a transformation of equation required because the roots are undergoing the same fate. So if alpha becomes this and beta becomes this, you can apply transformation to solve this question. Are you getting my point? Let me tell you, this method is very, very fast. Okay. But it has a limitation also. It will not work when, let's say, this becomes 3 alpha by alpha plus 2 and this remains, let's say, beta only. Then this method will not work. Right? Is this approach clear to you? Because approach is important. So please make a note of this approach. Okay. Why it works? I'll tell you why it works. Because, see, you are actually transforming the roots. And this transformation is basically applied to both the roots. That means the entire equation is undergoing the same transformation. Okay. So instead of separately finding out the sum and the product and then creating an equation out of it, you can directly apply this transformation. Let me give you a simple example. Let's say if your roots were alpha beta and I change them to alpha minus 2 beta minus 2. What is happening actually? Look at the graph. If let's say this was alpha and this was beta and you want your root to be alpha minus 2 and beta minus 2. What is happening to this graph such that these two will become the root? Can anybody tell me?
Move to the left.
Very good. So if I move it to the left, basically then I will achieve, basically I'm moving this by 2 units. Correct. So when the roots are undergoing the same fate, okay, you can actually make a change in the equation itself. Are you getting my point? By applying the same transformation, or you can say the reciprocal of the transformation. Now why I'm saying reciprocal of the transformation or inverse of the transformation is because if I want, let's say alpha beta was the root of this equation. Okay. If I want an equation with this two as the roots, okay, remember the process which I have discussed over here. What do I do? First of all, I put alpha in place of x. Correct? Secondly, I call this as x and make alpha the subject of the formula. So then I replace my alpha with 2 plus x or x plus 2, whatever you want to call it. Okay. Do you see that by doing this, you have taken this graph 2 units to the left? Remember, changing x with x plus 2, shift the graph 2 units to the left. Okay. So that is why, Aditya, this method works. Getting my point? Okay. Now I will do a quick exercise with you. Let us say alpha and beta are the roots of this equation. Okay. Quickly tell me an equation whose roots will be alpha minus k and beta minus k. Fast. Just tell me, what would you replace your x with?
X plus k.
Very good. This is something which should come very naturally to you after today's session. Very good. Okay. Next question. What if your roots become alpha plus k and beta plus k? What would you replace your x with?
Minus
x minus k. Very good. Do you realize what is happening? Okay, let's take few more cases, then I think it will be clear to you. What if you replace your alpha with k alpha and beta with k beta?
By k.
X by k.
Very good. This is what I wanted to you to appreciate. Okay. By the way, let me write as a equation. Sorry, I'm a zero. Acha, tell me this one. What about if I put alpha by k and beta by k?
Kx.
Kx.
Very good. Very good. Tell me what will happen if I do 1 by alpha, 1 by beta?
1 by x.
Absolutely. Absolutely. But this is not exactly in a quadratic shape. You have to bring it to a quadratic shape by multiplying with x squared. Very good. Acha, one tricky one also I'll ask you. What if I change it with alpha square and beta square?
Root x.
Very good. But when you write root x, you have to be careful, because the moment you write this as, the moment you take this fellow as x, alpha will become plus minus root x, correct? So it'll actually look like this. Alpha, sorry, ax plus minus b root x plus c, okay? Then you have to actually bring it to one side, let's say minus plus b under root x, and then square both the sides. So it actually becomes a square x square 2acx plus c square is equal to b square x, and then you club the like terms. Okay, this will be your final answer. Now I'm sure you would have got a hang of what is going on here. So one final question, okay? I'll give time for this. What if I replace my x with px minus, sorry, I replace my alpha with p alpha. Let me erase it, I messed it up. P alpha minus q and p beta minus q. What will I do?
So this is something like inverse functions.
Yes, it's working like, that's what I was trying to say. You are actually applying the inverse kind of transformation. Very good.
I think x plus q by p.
Very good. Very good. Okay. I'm not simplifying it. I'm leaving up to you to, you know, simplify this. My main agenda was to make the things clear to you. Okay. If this is clear, and if you're happy with this, may I ask you a question? Sorry, sorry.
So just a minute, could you go back?
Yeah, sure. Let me just dump the question, then we can go back. Let me dump the question. Yeah. Yes. You want me to scroll up or something?
Just could you show the question for a second?
Guys, I can't do two things at the same time. Somebody asked me to come to this page. Is that person done?
1 minute.
There's no need to copy, by the way. If there's something to ask, you can, you know, ask, because anyways the notes will be shared with you.
Sir, I copied it, sir. Thank you, sir.
Copied. Okay. Yeah. If alpha and beta are the roots of this equation, find the value of 1 minus alpha by 1 plus alpha whole cube and 1 minus beta by 1 plus beta the whole cube. Let's see how many of you get this correct. Let me put an option also so that I can check who all are correct. Option A, 10. Option B, minus 10. Option C, 8. Option D, minus 8. Let me run a poll. Let's have 3 minutes for this, not more than that. Guys, last 30 seconds. Last five. Everybody, please vote. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Go for it. Okay. End of poll. Look at the answer. Maximum people have gone for C. 63% people say 8. 26% people say B. And 11% people say D. Let's see what is the answer. Now, if you see this question, the moment I see this 1 minus alpha by 1 plus alpha, and the same with this, the transformation of equation comes in my mind. So let's say I call this expression as A, and I call this expression as inside one, not the overall. Let's say this inside one, I call it as A. So let me write it. Let's say A is 1 minus alpha by 1 plus alpha. And this inside expression, let me call it as B. Okay. Now, what are we looking for? We're looking for A cube plus B cube, right? Okay. And everybody knows the formula for this. A plus B the whole cube minus 3ab a plus b, right? Now, looking at this, what runs in my mind that somehow if I'm able to form an equation, let's say I'm able to form an equation with a and b as roots, then from that equation, I can know the sum, I can know the product by looking at the coefficient, right? That's the beta's relation, correct? And then I'll be able to apply it to this formula and my job is done. Okay, so now my effort is to find out that equation whose root will be a and b. That means these guys. Okay, again, let's take the normal root itself. So if alpha is the root of this, that means this condition will be true. Okay, then what I'll do is I'll call 1 minus alpha by 1 plus alpha to be x. Okay, and I will make x the subject of the formula. Guys, can you suggest me a quick way to get alpha in terms of x? Very good. Componendo and dividendo. So that will give me 1 minus x by 1 plus x. Okay, so let's place over here 1 minus x by 1 plus x whole square to 1 minus x, 1 plus x plus 1 equal to 0. Okay. Let us multiply with 1 plus x square whole throughout. So this will become this. This will become 1 minus x square. And this will become 1 plus x whole square. Okay. If you expand it, correct me, you'll have 2x square. Okay. And you'll get minus 6x, minus 4x. And there'll be a 6. Okay. That means you get x square minus 2x plus 3 equal to 0 as your equation. Okay. Now, if a and b are roots of this, can I say a plus b will be 2? That is minus b by a. This is your b. And ab will be 3 by beta's relation. Now, what is this beta's relation? I'll take care of it little later on after this problem itself. Okay. So I can say this value over here can be easily be found out by putting these values. That is 2 cube minus 3 into AB is 3. A plus B is 2. So answer is 8 minus 18, which is minus 10. Sorry, Janta, you were wrong. 63% of you said C. But the answer is B. Okay. Now, as a homework, I would like you to solve the very same question by now assuming that the roots are not 1 minus alpha, 1 plus alpha and this. Assume that the roots are 1 minus alpha by 1 plus alpha whole cube and 1, let's say, delta. 1 minus beta and 1 plus beta the whole cube. Please try to solve the same question by creating an equation whose roots are these two and then find the sum of the roots. Okay. So this is an alternative approach which I am giving you as a homework. Okay. Any question with respect to the approach, guys, please ask. No question. Now officially I'm going to talk about, Officially, I'm going to talk about beta's relation that I've been telling you from beginning, beta's relation. Beta's relation is basically the relationship between the roots and the coefficient of a polynomial equation. So it's basically a relation between the roots and the coefficients of any polynomial equation. Okay. So in quadratic, you already saw that relation. What was that? Alpha plus beta is minus b by a, and alpha into beta is c by a. So basically, you are connecting the coefficients with the roots. Okay. Now I'll be generalizing this. So let's say I have an nth degree polynomial like this. Okay. Now let's say the roots of this relation are, the roots of this polynomial equation are alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha 3, and so on till alpha n. Okay, by fundamental theorem of algebra. Okay, it must have n roots. Okay. Now the relation, beta relation, goes like this. If you add all the roots, that is what I'm writing in short form as summation of alpha 1. Please read this as I'm adding up alpha 1, alpha 2 till alpha n. It is actually minus 1 a1 by a0. That is what you used to call it as minus b by a. Okay. If you take the product 2 at a time, that means if you keep on taking every two terms or every two root and multiplying it, by the way, how many such values will come up? If you take any
minus two, one.
Huh? No, NC2. NC2 will come, Anjali. Okay, write it as alpha 1 into alpha 2 as a short form. The beta relation says it will be minus 1 square a2 by a0. Okay. In a similar way, if I take 3 at a time, that means sum of product of 3 at a time. By the way, how many such terms will come up?
NC3.
Three terms. Okay. Yeah. So this will become minus 1 to the power 3 a3 by a0. Do you see a pattern in this? So if I keep doing this, if I take summation of product of k at a time, of course k should be less than or equal to n, then this sum would be what? Okay, this is called the Vita's relation. Now many people ask me, how do you prove it? See, the proof is very easy. If you take your polynomial equation, let's say this is your polynomial equation, and you know your alpha 1, alpha 2 are the roots, can't you break it up like this? Yes? Okay. If you expand this and compare the coefficients of like powers, compare the coefficients of like powers of x, you will end up getting all these relations that you have seen. Okay, so you'll end up getting with the beta's relation. Is that fine? Any question here? Okay, so not only in a quadratic, you can apply it to a cubic, you can apply it to a biquadratic, you can apply it to any degree polynomial equation. Okay, I'll give you a simple example. For example, if you have a cubic equation, let's say ax cubed plus bx squared plus cx plus d equal to 0. And let's say roots are alpha, beta and gamma. Okay, so beta relation says that is summation alpha. This is what I'm writing it as a shortcut for this. It's actually minus b by a. Summation alpha beta, which actually is a short form of saying alpha beta, beta gamma, gamma alpha, that is going to be c by a. And your alpha beta gamma, that is nothing but minus d by a. So this relation will hold true for cubic as well. Is that fine? Now on this, I have a very, very interesting question. Okay. In fact, don't solve it. I'll be solving it. Okay. All of you just read the question first. Okay, done with the reading part?
Yes, sir.
So the question says, A1 is greater than A2, greater than A3, and so on till A6. P is that expression, Q is the other expression, R is another expression. And they have given you a cubic equation here. and they're asking you which of the following options are correct. So it's a multi-correct. Okay, let's say it's a multi-correct. Okay. Let me solve this question. But before I go into this question, I have an important theorem to discuss with all of you. Okay, so please be attentive. The last 20 minutes of the class, I think we should be able to wrap this up. The concept is intermediate value theorem, IVT. Now, intermediate value theorem is actually a very obvious theorem, which probably you will realize once I explain it to you. It says that if you have a polynomial equation, let's say f of x equal to 0. F of x equal to 0. Okay, so let's say it's a polynomial equation. Okay, even though it can be applied to other equations as well. But right now, since I'm talking about polynomial equations, I talk about this as a polynomial equation. Polynomial equation. Okay. Such that there are two values, alpha and beta, for which the polynomial function over here has opposite sign. Are you able to understand this? So let's say there's a polynomial equation and there's a polynomial function over here. And there are two values, alpha and beta, which you feed into this function. They will give you two answers which are of opposite sign. Okay. Then this theorem says that odd number of roots of f of x equal to 0 will lie between alpha and beta. Now let me explain why it happens. See, let us say I make the graph of this function, a rough graph. Okay. So let's say the graph is like this. Okay. Alpha is here. Let's say beta is here. Now you yourself will realize that the value of f of alpha, which is this value, is positive. Okay. And the value of the function at beta, which is here, f of beta, is negative. That means they are of opposite sign. Then you would realize that one root will definitely lie between alpha and beta. Now I've written odd roots. Why I've written odd number of roots? Because let's say your beta was here, then still they would have opposite sign, isn't it? Because now f of beta will still be negative. In that case, you'll have three roots between them. Are you getting my point? So your number of roots that will lie between alpha and beta will always be odd number, will always be a odd number of roots. Okay, so either it can be one root, or it can be three roots, or it can be five roots, or it can be seven roots. That depends upon what type of polynomial you have, or what is the degree of the polynomial you have. Is this understood or not? Any question with respect to this? Okay. If there's no question, then there's another follow-up. If f of alpha and f of beta has the same sign. Okay. Then it implies even number of roots of this function, of this polynomial equation will lie between alpha and beta. I'll repeat it once again, Aditya. Let me finish this off. Now, why even number of roots? So again, see, look at the same graph. I'm redrawing it again. So something like this. Okay. Let us say alpha is here and beta is here. Then only the value of f of alpha and f of beta will be having the same sign. Correct? Let's say. Yeah. If you see, if that were to happen, two roots will lie between alpha and beta. Now many people say alpha, let's say beta is here also, then same condition will hold true. In that case, zero roots will lie, but zero still is an even number. Okay. Now many people say, what if it touches and goes? So let's say alpha is here, beta is here. Still both are positive. Never mind. You still have even number of repeated roots. So this is a repeated root. Okay. Let's say this value is A. Then A is a repeated root. So A and A are two roots. Still the condition will hold good. Is it understood? I'll repeat once again. If let's say f of x equal to 0 is a polynomial equation given to you, right? And there are two numbers alpha and beta for which the function here, which is on the left hand side, gives you opposite signs. Then it implies odd number of roots of this equation lie between alpha and beta. If they give you the same sign, that means even number of roots of f of x equal to 0 lie between alpha and beta. Is that clear, Manjunath? Aditya Manjunath? Okay. Now with this understanding, let us solve this question. Okay, I'll do one thing. I'll copy this question on the next page also so that there's not hodgepodge over here, as there would be a hodgepodge. This was the question.
Sir, it doesn't matter whether roots are real or not, right?
No. I'm talking about real roots only.
Sir, but even if it's not, then there'll be zero roots between alpha and beta. So, won't it? Like, even if the root.
Oh, yeah. Zero real roots I'm talking about.
Yes, sir.
I'm talking about the roots here being real.
Okay, sir.
Okay, now let me solve this question for all of you. All of you, please see here. Okay, in the interest of time, I'm solving this. So let us first write down this equation. 2x cube minus p. What is p? a1, a2, a3, a4, a5, a6. Okay, x square. Plus qx. Q is this guy. a1, a3, a3, a5, a5, a1, a2, a4, a4, a6, a6, a2. Minus R. So minus, let me write it slightly more to the left. Minus A1, A3, A5, A2, A4, A6. Now this is a pattern in which these numbers are written. You can see here all the odd ones have been paired up. All the odd ones have been paired up. All the even ones have been paired up. All the odd ones have been paired up. All the even ones have been paired up. Okay. So now what I'll do is, taking clue from that, I will break up this equation into two equations. See how. One of the x cube I'll take from here, and all the odd numbers I'll pick up from here. A1, A3, A5. Okay. In a similar way, all the odd ones I'll pick up from here. A1, A3, A3, A5, A5, A1. Okay. And from here also, all the odd ones I'll pick up. Okay. Plus. Then the remaining x cube. And now this time the remaining even ones. A2, A4, A6. A2, A4, A4, A6. A6, A2. And from here, minus A2, A4, A6. Okay. Now everybody has understood till this step. So what I did, I broke this up as two different equations, two different expressions under the same equation. Is that clear, everybody? No doubt? Okay. Now recall Vita's relation. If you recall Vita's relation, this expression that you see, which I am underlining with yellow, it's actually nothing but x minus a1, x minus a3, and x minus a5. If you expand this up, you'll end up getting this. Yes or no? Plus. Now this expression, which I'm underlining with white, this is again from Vita's relation, x minus a2, x minus a4, x minus a6. Do you agree with me? So tactfully what I did, this equation that was given to me, I broke it up as two such expressions. Everything is fine till this stage. Please let me know.
Could you scroll up a bit?
Yeah, sure.
This sounds clear, sir.
Clear, please type clear on your screen so that I know it's clear to you. Clear? Okay. Good. Now listen to the music. Let's say I call this as my f of x. So basically there is a polynomial equation here that you are handling, f of x equal to 0, isn't it? Now look at the options. Option says one root lie between this, two root lie between this, blah, blah, blah. So they're all talking about how many roots are lying between these numbers. Okay. So for the first option, I have to see what is the sign of this polynomial f of x for a1 and a2. So can I do this act? Can you first find out what is the sign of f a1? Now let me put, forget about zero as of now. This you forget as of now. We'll talk about it. Let us just check f of a1. So in this function, if I put a x as a1, what will I get?
First
part will be zero. Okay. Second part will be a1 minus a2, a1 minus a4, and a1 minus a6. All of them are positive, positive, positive because a1 is greater than everything. Okay. So a1 minus a2 is also positive, a1 minus a4 is also positive, and a1 minus a6 is also positive. So it is positive value. Okay. Now, what about fa2? Fa2. Can anyone tell me fa2? Positive or negative? Let's erase this again.
Negative.
A2 will make this fellow as zero. And this will become a2 minus a1, a2 minus a3, and a2 minus a5. Negative, positive, positive. So yes, negative. Okay. Now, if there is a sign change happening, what does it mean? Odd number of roots of f of x equal to 0 lie between a1 and a2. So let me make a dummy graph. Let me make a dummy graph. Since this is a polynomial, since it is a polynomial with the leading coefficient as 2, so as you can see, the leading coefficient here is 2, so it will come from down like this. So it will come like this. Like this. Okay. And a1 has to be on the right. So a1 is somewhere over here. Okay, so a1 is positive. Now you're saying fa2 is negative. That means a2 could either be at this position. That means somewhere between these two roots. So these are the three roots. Or it could be here also, right? So either one root can lie or three roots can lie. Correct? I can only say odd number of roots can lie. I'm not very sure whether one root will lie or three roots will lie. So I will, as of now, park this because I don't have an idea whether one root will lie or three roots will lie. Okay. So I'm not in a position right now to say right or wrong for option A. Okay. So now I will move on to option B, what it says. It says two roots lie between A1 and A3. So A1 already we have seen the sign. Sorry. Let's see the sign of FA3. Can you help me with the sign of FA3? Again, let me erase this. A3 will make this as zero because there's an X minus A3 over here, but this will become A3 minus A2, A3 minus A4, and A3 minus A6. So this is negative, positive, positive. Correct? So this is a negative quantity. Okay. Now, if it is a negative quantity, either A3 can lie here, or A3 can lie here. There are two positions also for A3. Correct? But if A3 lies here, then there will be either one root between A1 and A2, or there would be three roots between A1 and A3. Sorry. If A3 lies here, there will be one root between A1 and A3, not A2, by mistake I said A2. Or if A3 lies here, there would be three roots between A1 and A3. So under no condition will have two roots. So this option is definitely wrong. This option is definitely wrong. Does it make sense? Okay. But unfortunately, still I have not got an answer for A. So let me move further. Let's check A1 and A4. So A1 is already known, positive. Let's say A4. Can you help me with the sign of FA4?
Positive.
Okay. This will become zero. Okay. This will become zero. A4 minus A1. A4 minus A3. And A4 minus A5. A4 minus A1 is negative. A4 minus A3 is also negative. A4 minus A5 is positive. Yes, correct. It's positive. It's positive. It's positive means if A2 lies here, A4 has to be to the left of A2. And it is positive. So it is somewhere over here. Right? Because it can't come over here, then it will be negative. If A4 is here, that means my A3 cannot be at this position. So these two are wrong positions. So my A2, A3 must be here. And if my A2, A3 is here, now I'm in a position to answer my option 1. That means this is correct. Sorry. This is correct. Okay. Is that clear why my A2 has to be in this position, not on this position? Because A4 is greater than A2, right? So it cannot lie here. It cannot lie to the right of A2. Okay. It can go on this side. Okay. A4 is lesser, so it has to go to the left. Okay. Now, two roots lie between A1 and A4. Two roots lie between A1 and A4. Yes, that is also correct. So option C is also correct. Let's look into D. Two roots lie between A3 and A5. So I need to know A5 sign also. Can you guys help me with A5 sign?
I think it's positive.
Sana is saying again positive. Are you sure, Sana?
Yeah, I calculated. I think it's
positive. Zero. This is negative, negative, positive. Yes, that's again positive. That means A5 has to be somewhere over here. Okay, it can't come in this branch. So between A3 and A5, only one root lies. That means even this option is wrong. Let me write it in black. Even this option is wrong.
So can you explain A5 again?
Okay, A5, if I put the values, what do I get?
Positive.
Yeah, positive. So positive means the function should show positive nature, right? So I can't have A5 here, right? Because A5 will become negative then, right? So it has to be in this loop only, somewhere between this point and this point. It has to be between this point and this point.
Okay.
Okay. So I just chose an arbitrary position. Let's say this position. So between A3, which is here, and between A5, which is here, there is exactly one root, which I'm showing with this white dot. Okay. That's why option D cannot be correct. Is that fine? Guys, this is a typical JEE advanced question. This type of analysis is what JEE wants you to be clear with. Okay, I know it has been a very tiring session. I'll not teach any further, but I'll just stop after telling you what is the things which are left for quadratic equation. So in sir, the next, sorry?
Sir, why did you start the graph going from down to up?
Okay, yeah. It's a very good question. Whenever you have a cubic polynomial, let me go back. Whenever you have a cubic polynomial with leading coefficient as positive, this is called the leading coefficient. Let me put it in. This is called the leading coefficient. If leading coefficient is positive, your cubic equation graph will always start from down and end upwards. Okay? I'll explain you. If ax cube plus bx square plus cx plus d is to be plotted, and if a is positive, the graph is always like this, okay? And it may not cut everywhere. I'm just giving you a rough example. It could be like this also, okay? It could be like this also, okay? But the left-hand side will always go to minus infinity and the right-hand side will always go to plus infinity. Why is that so? Is because if this is positive and your x becomes very, very negative in value, then the entire function will move towards negative infinity because this is the dominant term. Similarly, if your x becomes very, very large, then the entire quantity will move, become very, very large, irrespective of whatever is the sign of A, B, B, C, and D. Okay. That's why when you go towards plus infinity, this graph will also go towards plus infinity. And if you go towards minus infinity, the graph will also go towards minus infinity. Okay. On the other hand, if you have A as negative, your graph will look like this. Ulta. So in the left hand side, when you're going towards minus infinity, it will tend towards plus infinity. And on the right hand side, when you're going towards infinity, this will tend towards minus infinity. Getting the point?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Okay, I have a question. If I have a cubic in Y like this, okay, tell me if A is positive, how would the graph look like?
Down to.
Okay, I'm giving you two options. Like this. Or like this. Option A or option B?
A.
B.
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 B. B.
Okay, it's option B which is correct, because if A is positive and your Y is becoming very, very large, even X will be very, very large. Both are going towards infinity here. So X is becoming infinity, Y is also becoming infinity. So B is the answer. If your A were negative, then A would have been the answer. Okay. This is something related to the inverse function, which I'll do when I do the inverse. Yeah, meanwhile, the agenda for the next class would be, I'll talk about common roots first. Okay, I'll talk about common roots. This will be the first thing that I'll discuss. Then I'll talk about location of roots. And then I'll talk about polynomial equations in general, Descartes' rule, Rolle's theorem, Cardan's method of solving, all those things. So I'm not sure I will be able to do more than this. So this will be the agenda for the next class. So thank you so much. I'm going to stop here.